Recorded Books and RB Digital present Outside the Gates of Eden by Lewis Shiner, narrated by Andrew Garman. Part 1. 1965. 3:30, Cole's first day at the new high school. He hit the courts in his tennis whites, carrying his Jack Kramer racket in its wooden press. The St. Mark's courts were like nothing he'd seen outside of TV. Bright green composite surface, clean white lines, cloth nets on steel hawsers instead of the chain link he was used to. He was one of 24 boys. After 10 minutes of basic calisthenics, they milled around, waiting. The coach was named Fleming, young and skinny and earnest. Freshman English teacher, somebody said. Cole, Fleming said, reading from a clipboard, and Cole raised his hand. Fleming glanced at him and said, You and Montoya take court six. Let's see what you've got. Montoya was small and wiry, light-skinned despite the Mexican name. Short black hair parted on the left, good-looking and confident. Hell on women, Cole figured. Alex, Montoya said, offering his hand. Jeff, Cole said, but everybody calls me Cole. What year are you?
Junior.
Me too.
Transfer?
Yeah, I was at Midland.
You know where court six is?
He slacked off the wing nuts and slipped the racket out of the brace, then swung it in large circles to loosen up his shoulder.
The back 40.
Alex pointed with the head of his racket to a second row of concrete slabs behind the elegant composite courts. He grabbed two balls from the bucket at Fleming's feet.
Your dad in oil?
Kind of, Cole said. He's an accountant.
Much money in that?
Not really. I'm here on scholarship and against my will.
Alex cocked his head and Cole said,
No girls.
It's a drawback, Alex said.
The date was September 7th, the day after Labor Day, and the colors of the distant courts rippled in the Dallas heat. Cole had already felt that first cooling break of sweat under his arms and on his upper lip. Alex took the far side of the net, dropped a ball, and casually swatted it before it hit the ground. In 2 minutes, Cole had his number. He was exactly the kind of player that made Cole crazy. A scrambler who could get to anything and whose wild shots always nicked the line. Cole had made up for a lack of natural ability with hours of practice, focusing on technique, drilling against a backboard until the daylight was gone. He was a power player, with a hard topspin backhand that he liked to follow into the net. Unfortunately, he wasn't powerful enough. They took a few practice serves, then Cole said,
M or W?
M for Montoya.
Cole spun his racket and the Wilson logo on the handle landed upside down. He hit both balls to Alex. It went as badly as Cole expected. Alex's serves were nothing special, but every time Cole went to the net, Alex hit a deep lob that sent him scurrying to the baseline. Between that and the drop shots and bizarre spins, Alex easily won his serve. Cole himself had a nasty American twist that Alex couldn't handle. If Cole got the first serve in. When he fell back on his second serve, Alex got up to the same tricks. Cole held his first two serves, trailing 3-2 when Fleming showed up.
Montoya, get out of no man's land and quit hitting when you're out of position. Cole, if you're gonna take the net, put it away. And you're hitting late on your ground strokes and killing your power.
Cole dug in and pounded two serves in a row, and Alex sent both of them into the fence.
Nice serve, Fleming said. Let me see you mix it up a little.
As soon as Cole complied, Alex was all over it and took the game. Fleming moved on. Cole couldn't get the service break back and lost the set 6-4. As they walked toward the net, Alex flipped his racket around and held it like a guitar, pointing the handle up and contorting his face as he pretended to tear off a hot lick. Interesting, Cole thought. They shook hands across the net and walked to the sidelines.
I guess you don't know much of anybody here, right?
Alex said. Cole shrugged, still annoyed with himself for losing.
Why don't you come to my house for dinner Friday night? Alex said. My father is always after me to bring people home, and the food is pretty decent. I can bring you over after school. Over the years and many dislocations, Cole had developed the habit of making friends quickly.
Okay, he said. Thanks.
Cole followed Alex out to the St. Mark's parking lot after tennis on Friday. Their books were stacked on their notebooks under their left arms, their rackets in their right hands. They were in their fall uniforms, khaki pants with banlon polo shirts and a particularly fungal shape of taupe. Cole was a little nervous about being branded queer, though Alex seemed straight enough. And popular, based on the number of people who sat with him at lunch, a club that Cole had joined. Montoya's car turned out to be a red 65 Corvair Monza. Sleek, compact, sporty, engine in the rear. Cole stopped to admire it.
This got the 110 horses?
140, Alex said. Not that I get much chance to open it up. You know cars?
I used to help out in the motor pool.
The red tuck and roll upholstery was hot enough to pop the sweat on Cole's freshly showered back. He followed Alex's lead and threw his books and racket in the back seat. Alex had a cushion to put himself higher behind the wheel. He cranked the engine and the radio came on with it, blasting rock and roll. Big skating rink type organ and tinny piano and a tired sounding singer.
Check it out, Alex said. You heard this yet?
Cole shook his head.
It's the new Dylan single. Dig it.
Cole had heard of Dylan, but not heard him. Midland was solidly country western, and his father ordered him to get up and change the channel whenever music groups came on TV. Most of the rock bands that Cole had heard sounded crude. He liked movie themes and John Coltrane, the Kingston Trio and Bobby Darin. His parents had an ancient monaural phonograph, and Cole didn't have any records of his own. The song was over by the time Alex exited the parking lot and made a left onto Preston. He turned the volume down and said, "You like Dylan?"
"I don't know," Cole said. "How come you've got your license already? Are you even 16 yet?"
16 next month. It's a hardship license.
He looked at Cole and grinned.
My parents felt like it was a hardship to drive me around.
Cole's parents felt the same way, but in his case, it meant he didn't get out much.
How long you been in Dallas? Alex asked.
Since June. Worked all summer in my father's office, making coffee, running errands, shit like that.
It's cool that you got to move around.
Mostly from one armpit to another. Before Midland, I was in Egypt for a year. That was where I learned to work on cars. We got out just before Nasser nationalized the oil. Midland for 2 years before that. Mexico for a year before that. New Jersey before that.
Which armpit of Mexico?
Cole flushed. No offense, but we were in Villa Hermosa, which was not, in fact, very Hermosa.
Why should I be offended?
He wants me to point out that he's Mexican, Cole thought. He shut up rather than give him the satisfaction. It was starting to look like a long evening.
Relax, Cole, I'm just giving you shit. My father's from Guanajuato, which is in fact pretty Hermosa, and I agree that Villa Hermosa is pretty much an armpit. I myself have lived my entire life in Dallas, and I'm not convinced that you haven't landed in an armpit yet again.
Alex was nervous despite himself as he parked behind the house. You could see that there was something about this Cole character, as his mother already called him. Alex felt like his own attempts at coolness were transparently lame, whereas Cole was the real deal, standing outside looking in, not with hunger, but with indifference. They got out of the car and he watched Cole take it all in, the pristine driveway, the perfectly rectangular hedges, his sister's red T-bird convertible, the privacy fence and the pool beyond it, the two-story brick house less than 10 years old.
Nice, Cole said. What does your father do to get this kind of bread?
Import-export, real estate. He's got a piece of the Cuauhtémoc brewery in Monterey. I don't even know anymore where it all comes from. Once you get past a certain point, being rich is a full-time job all by itself.
You don't approve?
It's not that simple. I love my father. I just don't want to be him.
The garage door was up, and they walked between his father's Eldorado and his mother's Impala, through the laundry room and into the kitchen. Alex's mother was washing lettuce in the sink while Frederica sliced potatoes on the counter. His mother's hair was in a loose ponytail, and she was wearing capri pants and a tight sweater like somebody half her age. She'd barely turned 20 when she had Alex, and she was fanatical about watching Jack LaLanne and working out to fitness records. She dried her hands on her apron as she kissed Alex and said,
"Hola, mijo."
"Mom?"
"Sorry, sorry."
"Hi, Alex."
"And this is Cole?"
"Hi," Cole said.
He took her hand European style, like he was going to kiss it.
"You must be Alex's sister?"
"Points for charm," she said.
"You can stay."
"Dad home?" Alex asked.
"Not yet."
Alex wondered if her false cheer was obvious to Cole.
"Susan's here for the weekend."
She looked at Cole.
"Susan really is his sister. She's a freshman at UT.
Alex told me.
She nodded to Frederica.
"And this is Frederica."
"I'm Cole.
Anything I can do to help?"
Frederica shook her head like Cole was crazy, and Alex's mother said,
"Is he always like this?"
"I barely know the guy," Alex said.
"Like what?" Cole said.
"You guys run along," his mother said. "I'll call you when dinner's ready."
Alex led the way upstairs. He'd remembered to make the bed that morning, at least. He sat on the bed and Cole pulled the wooden chair out from the desk and sat backwards on it. Cole eyed the guitars and amplifier, the stereo and the stack of records leaning against the wall.
"What kind of music do you like?"
Alex asked. You could see from Cole's shrug that he was embarrassed.
"Come on, man, what's the big deal? You into opera or some shit like that?"
"No, it's... I don't know much about rock and roll."
"Yeah, I figured. Like, rock and roll is oldies, okay? Like the Platters and shit. Just plain rock is what's happening now."
Cole nodded like he was taking mental notes. "You play guitar?"
"At it," Alex said. "I'd have to work a lot harder to be any good. Lately, I've been playing bass because it's easier. If I was in a group, that's what I'd play. Did you like Positively 4th Street, that Dylan song in the car?"
"I think so, maybe."
Alex thought it over and said,
"Here's the deal. You help me clean up my tennis game, and I'll help you with your appalling ignorance about music, okay?"
Cole nodded again. Alex took out Highway 61 Revisited.
"Lesson one," he said.
50-some minutes later, and Cole's head was spinning. The instruments on the record were clangy, and some of them were out of tune. Instead of ruining everything, it only made the music sound more urgent. Then there was Dylan's voice, like something he used to know and had forgotten. The voice of somebody too clever for his own good, hurt and lonely and rejecting before he was rejected. Like looking in a mirror and seeing somebody far more mysterious than he'd ever seen there before. Alex surprised him by not asking what he thought, which Cole did not want to put into words at that moment. It must have been all over his face because Alex said,
"Okay, now we're getting somewhere."
They went downstairs. Half of Cole was still out on Highway 61, or in the rain in Juarez, or maybe on Desolation Row. The other half dimly registered an oak-paneled dining room, a chandelier, an oval table 12 feet long laid out with linen tablecloth, candles, real silver. A 2-foot-tall wooden crucifix next to a framed picture of the Virgin. At one end sat Alex's father, 5'10 and massively built, with short curly hair and a neatly trimmed mustache. The only other person at the table was a younger, blonder version of Alex, maybe a 5th grader, sitting in front of a glass of milk. Alex's father stood up and held out his hand.
"Al Montoya, good to meet you."
only the slightest hint of an accent, more in the rhythm than the pronunciation. Jeff Cole. He was ready for a firm handshake, and he got it. Alex hugged his father, and his father kissed him on the cheek. Cole, startled, looked away. And this is Jimmy, Montoya said. The kid shook hands too and said, Hi. Alex's mother came in, holding a bowl of something in a red quilted mitt. From the look of it, Cole thought it might be potatoes au gratin, something he'd read about but never eaten. Then again, he'd never known anyone with a black maid before, or cars for everybody in the family old enough to drive.
You're here, Cole, she said, pointing to a chair one away from Montoya. Go ahead and sit down.
He didn't, of course. Being poor didn't mean you couldn't have manners, his mother had told him a million times. She read Emily Post and Amy Vanderbilt and never got to use them. You want a beer? Alex asked. Sure. He didn't let himself look at Montoya to see if they were pulling his leg. Bohemia, all right? Alex said. Whatever you're having. Montoya said, If you're not familiar with it, it's got a richer flavor than the U.S. beer you're probably used to. Cole nodded as if he were used to anything other than an occasional pilfered sip of his father's Schlitz. Let me know what you think, Montoya said. I'll do that, Cole said. Alex's mother set the potatoes next to the rest of the food on the table. Huge wooden bowl of salad, fresh green beans instead of canned, cut diagonally and sautéed with mushrooms, loaves of French bread torn to pieces and poking out of a checkered napkin in a basket, glass butter dish and silver butter knife, steaming bowl of wild rice, pitchers of water and lemonade. She sat at her husband's right hand and said, Susana, ben estamos listos. Alex, who'd come back with two brown bottles of beer, glared at her. Montoya cleared his throat. Cole shifted uncomfortably, and then Susan walked out of the kitchen. She was darker than Alex, with lustrous black hair that flipped inward at her shoulders, like a fashion model's. Petite, graceful, completely out of Cole's league. Except for the wounded look in her eyes. It matched the pain in Dylan's voice, and Cole wanted to believe that no one saw it but him. She carried a Pyrex serving dish full of rare steak, sliced into strips and garnished with parsley. She set it on the table and held out her hand.
You must be Cole.
I suppose I must, he said, but I can try to change. She offered him the charity of her smile. The only unclaimed chair was next to his, so he pulled it out for her. She thanked him, and then Cole, the last man standing, finally took his own seat. No matter how hungry you are, his mother had taught him, be patient. Watch the hostess and follow her lead. What she did was hold her hands out, palm up, and the others around the table joined hands and bowed their heads. Jimmy, Montoya said, will you do the honors?
Bless this food to our use and us to thy service. The kid said, make us ever mindful of the needs of others.
Cole, a devout atheist since age 12, didn't join the chorus of amens. He let his attention linger on the feel of Susan's hand in his, small, soft, warming to his touch. He was careful to release it at the first sign of her letting go. He took small portions as the serving dishes came around. Said, everything smells wonderful, and braced himself to tell his life story over again. Instead, Montoya asked him what he thought of the Gemini 5 flight.
I can't imagine, Montoya said, what it must be like to be stuck inside a big tin can for a week. I would go crazy.
At Cole's house, they ate on TV trays in front of the big black and white console set, and Cole's father complained, if anyone tried to talk over the news. If Cole's father was home, the TV was on, so they never had any conversation at all, which was okay with Cole, as his father found something to object to in most anything Cole said.
It might be worth it for the sights, Cole said. The thing that would drive me crazy is having so little control. It's all done by computers and the ground crew.
Cole had all 55 TOPS astronaut cards from 2 years before. Montoya nodded.
That would get to me, too.
At the first lull, Cole looked at Susan, who hadn't spoken since her amen.
How do you like UT? It's really big, right?
30,000, Susan said. Some of my lecture classes have 200 or 300 people in them. The hard part is getting the prerequisite classes for your major. Sometimes they don't have enough sections, and you can get stuck in a holding pattern for years.
She was acting, Cole thought, as if he were a human in his own right, and not just her little brother's friend.
Do you know what you're going to major in?
Jimmy, barely audible, said,
Football players.
Susan blushed, and her mother said,
Jimmy, apologize to your sister. Sorry, Susan.
He drew the words out in a sing-song. Cole's own face felt hot. Of course she was dating football players and probably majoring in home ec. What had he expected, Russian lit?
No, Susan said. I don't know yet.
The pain in her eyes was connected to this, and he couldn't possibly ask her about it at the dinner table. Or anywhere else, he reminded himself. Alex played it cool, keeping one eye on Cole as they ate. You could see he knew how to handle people. Say something to make them feel good about themselves, the oldest gimmick in the book, and that shit always worked, even on his father, who prided himself on not getting bluffed at the poker table. The trick was in the delivery, pretending he was kidding while at the same time coming off like he really meant it. It was a kind of non-sexual flirting, and he must have figured it out early on. You would need to make friends fast moving around like that. Cole finished his beer and smoothly got Alex's father talking about the brewery.
You want another? Alex asked.
Sure, Cole said.
I'll get it,
Susan said, pushing back her chair and ignoring both Cole's token protest and their father's raised eyebrow.
Anybody else?
Alex raised his own nearly empty bottle, pleased at the way he and Susan and Cole had taken advantage of the situation. Yes, Alex thought. I think he'll do. Alex and his father and Cole stayed at the table until after 9. Cole didn't give up his attempts to help with the dishes until Alex's mother promised him, next time. Cole had eaten 3 helpings of everything and completely won her over.
Cole lived in Villa Hermosa for a year, Pop,
Alex said.
Really? How old were you?
I turned 10 there.
Do you speak any Spanish?
I can get by. Between that and Spanish classes at school. You could see that Cole wanted to ask why they didn't speak it at home. Why the dirty looks when his mother used it. Even so, he'd read the mood well enough to answer in English. Eventually, Alex said,
It's late. I'd better take him home.
You've had 2 beers, his father said. You're not driving. Susan can take him. Alex stood up abruptly.
Let's go then.
Cole thanked everyone extravagantly, including Frederica, and then he and Alex went outside to wait on Susan. She's got to brush her teeth, Alex said, and fix her hair and freshen her makeup, in case Prince Charming pulls up next to her at the light. She seems nice. Alex shrugged.
Don't forget your books.
Cole got his stuff out of the Monza and after an awkward minute said, Are you pissed off about something?
I hate it when my father treats me like a kid.
We're 15 years old, Cole said. We are kids.
When he was my age, he was working 12 hours a day and bringing home most of the family's money, and he didn't take shit from anyone, including his old man.
A floodlight snapped on above them, and Susan made her entrance.
Shall we?
She said. She'd carefully tied a scarf over her hair, and her lips shone. Cole moved quickly to open the driver door of her T-Bird, then glanced at Alex and said,
Shotgun.
Alex got in and stretched both his arms across the back of the seats. Cole gave directions while Susan backed out. They cut over to Marsh and cruised north, 3 lanes each way, traffic sparse, the late summer wind pinning Alex's shirt to his chest. The nearness of fall made him lonely and impatient.
The Dylan concert is the 25th, Susan said. I'm getting tickets Monday morning before I go back. You want any?
Cole, Alex said. You interested? I have to ask my parents, but yeah, definitely.
He looked at Susan. Do you need money tonight? Alex knows where to find you, she said.
That's right, Cole said. Whenever you need me.
The girls in Mr. Casey's civics class had pronounced him a hunk. All but Madeline. She found it alarming that he was so clearly aware of his good looks and that he took so much pleasure in the way the girls responded to him. His dark hair was unkempt and slightly too long. His tattersall shirts and knit ties were daringly casual. His smile radiated inappropriate warmth.
Miss Brooks, he said, will you tell the class the subject you chose for your essay?
Madeline had been dreading this moment. They'd spent the first few weeks of class discussing a major paper due mid-semester, and on Monday they'd had to turn in preliminary topic paragraphs. Now Mr. Casey was calling on the students he thought had provided good examples, with the idea that this would somehow inspire those who hadn't. Rather than, in fact, make them sullen, jealous, and resentful. Madeline's strategy for surviving high school centered on the avoidance of negative attention. On a tactical level, this meant not doing anything to emphasize her quiet good looks, not binding herself to any of the social cliques that she easily moved among, and above all, not making a display of her erudition.
It's, about the crisis in Greece.
I don't think, Mr. Casey said, most of us know about this crisis. Can you explain it? And stand up, please, Miss Brooks, so we can all hear you.
She reluctantly got to her feet. Keep it simple, she reminded herself.
Well, it's a monarchy there, and the new king just took over, and he's very young and kind of pushy. He forced the prime minister to resign, but the prime minister is really popular, so none of the king's replacements have been able to win a vote of confidence.
And this is important because?
Madeline felt herself get caught up against her will.
Because the power struggle is over who controls the army. Like in most countries, the Greek army is deeply conservative, and they don't like the wave of liberalism that's been happening over the last few years. If the civilian government can't hold power, the army could take over and impose a right-wing dictatorship.
She must have let some emotion into her voice because she heard, from the back of the room, Ed Wallingford say,
Big woo!
Ed, the kicker and the smallest boy on the football team, was given to deflating what he saw as pretension. Mr. Casey said, Your title is The July Apostasy in Greece. Can you explain that? His wrong-headed attempt to hold her up for admiration, she knew, would only end in ridicule.
That's what they call it over there.
She looked at Mr. Casey and saw that he wanted more.
The prime ministers that the king appointed were members of the first guy, Papandreou's party, so Papandreou's people called them apostates. Traitors, basically.
Where did you get all this?
We listen to the BBC sometimes.
In fact, she and her father ritually tuned in the BBC Overseas Service, since March called the BBC World Service nearly every weeknight.
And Greece. Why Greece?
That, Madeline thought, was not of Mr. Casey's beeswax.
Greece is the cradle of democracy. If they became a military dictatorship, the symbolism would be pretty ominous.
Excellent, Miss Brooks. I very much look forward to reading your paper.
Me too,
muttered Ed Wallingford, prompting antiphonal sniggering on the back row. When the bell finally released her from her agony, Madeline got out of the classroom as fast as she could, unable to bear any more of Mr. Casey's veneration or Ed Wallingford's hostility. It could have been worse, she supposed. Mr. Casey could have kept at her until he got to the truth of her fascination with Greece. As much as her father doted on her, Madeline's mother was the one who read her to sleep when she was little. They must have started with the usual little golden books and then moved to the A.A. Milne. What Madeline remembered was the night her mother set the house at Pooh Corner aside and said,
Would you like to try something different?
Madeline was 3, and this would be her earliest memory. Yes, she said, not having a real opinion of her own, responding purely to her mother's excitement. Her mother went away and came back with a thick book wrapped in an orange paper cover. She turned a few pages and began to read. Tell me, O Muse, she began. And then she said something about heroes and sacks and Ilion. Her mother looked up. Ilion, of course, that would be Troy. Madeline had laughed then, because she had no idea who Troy was either, or what a muse was, or what it was that was getting put in a sack. Over the years, she returned repeatedly to that S.O. Andrew translation of the Odyssey, sometimes reading no more than a few lines. She'd absorbed enough about romantic love long before the upheavals of puberty to grasp the concept. The perfect lover was always available, always consoling, able to sweep you away from mundane reality, to obsess you, to steal your heart. How could the Mr. Caseys of this world, let alone the Ed Wallingfords, ever compare to books? Dave had come to Greenwich Village for the first time on a stifling Friday night in August of 1961. 6 foot minus a little, scrawny, 25, and already losing his hair. He'd never set foot there, despite growing up in Yonkers and 2 years at New York City Community College, and 4 years working in Midtown after graduation. From childhood, his parents had warned him about the Bolsheviks and gypsies and dope fiends of the village, to the point where, even as an adult who knew better, he feared that if he went and got into trouble, God forbid, he would never hear the end of it. On that particular night, he'd fled his airless Brooklyn apartment after another horrible scene with Rachel, her shouting, him retreating until he'd found himself in the hall, smelling overcooked cabbage and exhaust fumes from the air shaft, sick to death of his life so far. For no conscious reason, he'd gotten on a train headed into Manhattan. A self-destructive impulse, planted by Rachel's venom and brought to fruition by the sight of the Bleecker Street station, had sent him off the train and up the stairs and out onto Lafayette. As he walked up Bleecker past NYU and into the village proper, he could see the history in every brick, some of which had no doubt been hurled at policemen. From the bohemian painters of the 20s and 30s to the radical theaters and playwrights of the 40s, from the beats of the 50s to the current jazzmen and folkies, the village had witnessed a continuous outpouring of dissent that was as alien to Dave as fakirs walking on hot coals. Back when his name was Fishel Cohen, he had grown up with Zionist folk songs, and when the Weavers put Tsena, Tsena, Tsena on the flip of Goodnight Irene, he was permitted to buy a copy. The guitars and the unrestrained power of the voices touched something in him as frightening as it was compelling. Years later, still in college, he heard the same thing in the Kingston Trio's Tom Dooley. So he knew the names, the Village Vanguard, Gertie's Folk City, the Cock and Bull, even though he'd always believed himself too old, too married, too square to ever act on that knowledge. At the intersection of Bleecker and McDougal, the excitement seized him in the pit of his stomach, a feeling indistinguishable from the terror he felt when he walked past a cluster of duck-tailed, lucky-smoking motorcycle-jacketed hoods on Flatbush Avenue. This crowd was more benign, dressed the same way as Dave, in white short-sleeved shirts and narrow ties and shiny black floorshimes. Yet they had an air of knowledge and purpose that had always eluded him. He followed a group of them up McDougal and ended up in a line 20 people long that led down the stairs to the Gaslight Cafe. 15 minutes after he crowded into a damp, unbearably hot basement, where every table was filled and the overflow leaned against every inch of available space along the bare brick wall, the only light came from the occasional fake Tiffany lamp that hung from the ceiling, and Dave had to walk with his hands in front of him until his eyes adjusted. On stage, A guy in an elegant suit and a neatly trimmed brown beard manipulated the microphone to produce startlingly realistic sound effects, creating characters through weird voices and then tossing them aside, dispensing with punchlines in favor of building and abandoning entire surrealist worlds. When he finished, everybody snapped their fingers instead of applauding, and Dave began to suspect he was asleep and dreaming in Brooklyn.
First time here?
Dave turned to see a stunning black-haired woman in black-framed glasses, jeans, and a black sweater that was coming off one shoulder. He nodded.
Apartments upstairs, the woman said, pointing.
She spoke with exaggerated clarity to be heard without raising her voice.
Same air shaft, people complaining about the noise.
She ended on a smile.
Who was that guy?
Hugh Romney, on staff here.
Overwhelmed by shyness, Dave nodded thanks and turned away. A hugely tall man with a thick mustache and brown hair that fell in his eyes arrived on stage and sat on a stool with his guitar. He joked with the crowd and then began to pick intricate patterns and sing in a raw, powerful voice. Some of what the man played was what Dave had always thought of as folk music, and some was blues, jazz, Dixieland, gospel, and anything else that came into his head. Between two of the songs, he turned and gave the black-haired woman a questioning look.
Dave Van Ronk,
she seemed amused. He'd heard of Van Ronk. Everybody in the music business expected him to be huge, and nobody would take a chance on him other than the village's own beatnik label, Folkways. Van Ronk played for an hour and a half and then announced Brownie McGee and Sonny Terry, a guitar player and a blind harmonica player, both Negro. Dave's parents had told him that in the village, the Schwarzers mixed with the Goyim on the streets, in the clubs, even in the bedrooms. It still struck Dave as very odd, not objectionable, merely strange. And speaking of mixing, Van Ronk had obviously paid close attention to McGee's guitar playing and singing style. Eventually, he wandered out onto the street and let himself be drawn up McDougal to Washington Square. In April, there had been a so-called beatnik riot there after the city had tried to shut down the Sunday afternoon folk singing. Naturally, the city won. Dave arrived to find the police enforcing a 6 p.m. curfew on musical instruments. He sat at the central fountain anyway and listened to the kids as they passed around cigarettes and argued, mostly about ideological purity of one kind or another. Clawhammer versus Scruggs-style banjo picking. Negro blues versus child ballads. Hammered dulcimer versus guitar. After that, he'd walked the streets until daylight, fueled by espresso and an anxious, irresistible excitement. That had been the start. After he separated from Rachel, he rented a cheap fourth-floor walk-up on Sullivan Street and over the next 6 months began to make sense of the emotional onslaught. Seeing Fred Neil at the Café Wa, Bob Dylan at Gertie's, and Tim Harden at the Night Owl had shown him why Van Ronk was not going to be famous beyond the village. The zealots in Washington Square had missed the same thing that Van Ronk had. The problem was not a failure of authenticity, but rather an excess of it. This was not shaping up to be a decade of reverence. Dave had been an engineer at Columbia Records since 1957, since he'd shown up with 2 years of college credits and convinced them to give him a try. That first week, an old Jew in accounting had looked at the name on his paperwork and shaken his head.
Fishel Cohen? I don't think so.
What do you mean?
You get credit on an album cover. That's what people should read.
We can fix this.
Fishel.
Fisher.
Cohen.
Ken.
Turn it around.
Ken Fisher.
Ken?
You want me to be a Ken?
What else you got for me?
Well, my middle name is Dove.
Perfect. David Fisher.
The deed was done before he had time to think.
and it seemed a minor thing until his first paycheck arrived, made out to David Fisher. Accounting said it could take months to correct, and it would be simpler to open an account in the new name. Within a month, the pressure of trying to maintain two identities was driving him meshuggah, and he gave up and went before a judge and made it legal. It wasn't like he had any affection for Fischl. He'd been called fish breath in grade school and fishy in the army, and it was only stubbornness that had kept him from changing it before. Telling his parents was another thing. A month and a half went by before they let him in their house again, and even then they barely spoke to him. Rachel had been even worse. Though she had watched the process unfold and nodded along with each step, she managed to hold it against him in the end. Then again, Rachel had held most everything against him. In February of 1962, Dave told Mitch Miller, his boss at Columbia, that he wanted to record some of the new folk music. He had by that point worked his way up from second-tier easy listening dates to full orchestra sessions with Tony Bennett and the latest Sing Along with Mitch album, even as the TV show was burning up the ratings. Miller had sneered. "You mean they actually use engineers on that garbage? Why?" Dave had always had a grudging respect for Miller, though many considered him a schlockmeister for stunts like pairing Sinatra with a howling dog and letting a 13-year-old sing, "I Saw Mommy Kissing Santa Claus." Miller had invented the idea of the record producer, along with the idea that a record could be an art form in itself, and not just a souvenir of a live performance. He was the absolute monarch of the church, Columbia's 30th Street studio, generally considered the best-sounding room in the world. 100 feet long, wide, and high, with an echo chamber in the basement that was the envy of the industry. Miller's shovel-blade beard, two-armed conducting style, and the tight smile were national icons. The public never saw his self-confidence cross the line into arrogance, or heard his contemptuous dismissal of contrary opinions. Dave's penalty for his disloyalty was exile to Studio A, uptown on 7th Avenue. Miller never spoke to him again, even when they passed in the hall. Once free of his influence, Dave began to see that Miller had helped turn the musical culture of the 1950s into a sterile wasteland of artifice and made-to-order sentiment, had created the very famine of authenticity that the kids in Washington Square were rebelling against. The contrast between Miller's world and the future that was barreling toward them became more obvious every day. In February of 1964, on the Ed Sullivan Show, the Beatles served notice of that future to every pop musician in the U.S. The following May, Tim Hardin showed up at Columbia to record a set of demos. Dave had fought to get assigned to the session, only to have it explode into chaos before it started. The schedule listed it as a solo recording, and Hardin arrived with an entourage that included musicians, hangers-on, and his own producer, a 6'6" baritone blonde named Eric Jacobson, who was the banjo player in some folk group with a kooky name. John Sebastian was there, the harmonica player that Dave had seen playing with Fred Neil. So was Gary Burton, the jazz vibraphonist, and Styx Evans, with his left-handed drum set and his dapper three-piece suit and pocket handkerchief. So was a huge, loud woman named Cass, a wild man named Zalman, a kleptomaniac named Pompa, and various other musicians and women of little or no virtue. It quickly became apparent that Hardin was completely loaded on heroin. Cass, Zalman, Jacobson, and Sebastian began smoking reefer in the hall. Every time Dave turned around, Pompa was gone and something else was missing. A typewriter, a chair, pictures off the walls. As soon as Hardin got a few bars into a song, he would nod out, and the other musicians sat and waited until he drifted back in and picked up, in perfect time, exactly where he'd left off. "God watches over fools,"
Dave's mother had always claimed, and somehow they got through the 12-hour session without the intervention of police, firemen, doctors, or Columbia executives. And when he replayed the tapes afterward and heard, amid the endless variations on the high-heel sneakers riff, the beauty and pain in Hardin's voice on How Time Flies, his heart swelled up, and he phoned Jacobson and babbled incoherently, until Jacobson invited him over to his apartment on McDougal, where he and Sebastian were listening to country and blues and jug band music on Reel to Reel, and where they told him their stories. How they'd been living in adjacent rooms in a transient hotel in the village, unbeknownst to each other, until one night, Sebastian came knocking at 2 a.m., asking Jake to turn the music up. And how Jake had heard the Beatles on a jukebox in a White Castle while on the road with the Knoblick Upper 10,000, and started to hear sounds in his head that he couldn't make as a musician, but thought he could create as a producer. And how Cass had introduced Sebastian to Zolly at her apartment on the night the Beatles had debuted on Sullivan, having already decided that they should be in a band together, and they'd played together for the first time then. Sebastian the technician, Zoll the free spirit, dripping influences from Floyd Kramer's Slipknot piano to Louis Armstrong's air raid trumpet to Clifton Chenier's blustering accordion. And now it looked like Zoll was part of their conspiracy, the band they were going to form as a sort of American armed response to the British invasion. And Dave, his judgment perhaps affected by the clouds of pot smoke floating in the room, had said, "Take me with you." Columbia understandably passed on the Hardin demos. Dave assumed that was the end of it. But when the Lovin' Spoonful finally materialized, Jake remembered him. The band cut their first demos at Bell and Allegro, top-notch rooms, with state-of-the-art gear, and Dave moonlighted as engineer to be part of it. He found to his surprise that he belonged there, in the thick of the creative whirlwind, putting a pickup on an auto harp, or underdubbing to create new hybrid instruments that blended guitars and pianos, or guitars and tubular bells. Jake taught him how to splice tape to resurrect brilliant fictional performances from the ashes of failed takes. They created every sound they could imagine, and they went beyond that to create sounds even they had never imagined before. And then suddenly, September of 1965 arrived, and Do You Believe in Magic broke nationwide, and here on this Thursday night in the village, Dave was walking down 3rd Street to listen to the Spoonful for possibly the last time ever at the Night Owl, because after extended dates in L.A. and San Francisco, they had outgrown not just the club, but the village itself. He saw then that he had blinked and missed another cultural warm front that had blown through and changed everything, had swapped out bulging, long-necked acoustic guitar cases for flat fender rectangles, banished jackets and ties, grown hair over collars and ears, put women into jeans and sandals and jangling jewelry. We did this, he thought. The Beatles and the Spoonful and the bands in garages everywhere. We electrified the world. The street around the Night Owl's famous yellow awning seethed with kids, locals and tourists both, a testament to the success of the record. Dave knew from experience that the volume of the band made them a more pleasant auditory experience on the sidewalk than inside. Jake knew it too, and Dave found him 50 yards from the club, his blonde head poking up past the crowd around him. Dave made his way over, and Jake threw one arm around him and pulled him into a hug. Jake was dapper, as always, in a double-breasted suit and no tie, while Dave, who had no instinct for clothes, wore a short-sleeved sports shirt and gray slacks. This guy, Jake said to no one in particular. This guy is going to be huge once he flies the nest and starts producing on his own. Dave felt the opposite of huge, dwarfed by Jake's physicality and outsized personality. You want to go inside? Jake asked, and Dave shrugged. The crowd made way for them, and Jack the Rat, at the door of the club gave them a gap-toothed smile and waved them in. The interior was barely more than a hallway, 20 feet wide and long enough to disappear into darkness at the far end. The stage protruded from the middle of one wall, so small that Joe had to set up his drums on the floor at stage left. The PA speakers pointed outward from the sides of the stage so that the vocals rode high above the instruments. Zal was in full wild man mode, dancing jerkily back and forth like he had to take a leak. Tall and lean, in vertically striped stovepipe pants and a top hat. He was to blame for the crippling volume, cranking his guitar until the rest of the band had no choice other than to go along or be swallowed up. They were in the middle of Chuck Berry's Almost Grown. Sebastian waved to Jake and smiled happily, and Zal nodded and raised his guitar neck in salute. Heads turned and failed to recognize who the salutes were for. Dave saw Jake's gaze move over the room, checking out the girls, winnowing out the underage, a more difficult feat every day. Suddenly, Dave felt a hand on his shoulder, pulling him down toward the floor. He turned and saw Tim Harden, feeling a surge of disappointment, followed immediately by guilt. Harden had turned Jake around at the same time, and now he was smiling, arms open wide, his long brown forelock falling to his eyebrows across the wide plane of his forehead, one eye glittering with mischief and tragedy, the other squinting against the smoke from the cigarette parked in the corner of his mouth. He looked fairly straight, Dave thought hopefully. The volume prohibited even the pretense of conversation. Jake gripped Harden's shoulder in greeting, and Dave nodded awkwardly. Harden pointed to his ears and led them to the street.
"I thought you were still in L.A., Jake said.
"What's the matter? Aren't you glad to see me?"
Harden never expressed fewer than two highly volatile emotions at once. Here, his petulance teetered on the edge of laughter.
"Sure, Timmy, always."
Jake was less than convincing, on the verge of losing patience, while Dave was willing to cut Harden more slack on the basis of the incredible music they were in the midst of recording. Jake had come up with the idea of buying Harden a portable tape recorder and paying him $50 for every demo that had at least two verses and a chorus, $75 if it had a bridge. The scheme was working. These were brand new songs that finally did justice to that amazing, heartbroken voice and the virtuoso guitar playing that sounded like Robert Johnson duetting with Django Reinhardt. The lyrics deceptively simple and full of surprising images and naked emotion. Once Verve released the album and Harden became a household name, bigger than Dylan, bigger than Sinatra, Dave was sure that the recognition would chase away the demons that were riding him so very hard.
"Do you want me to set up some studio time?" Dave asked.
"Tomorrow, definitely."
"What time tomorrow?" Jake said.
"I don't know yet. I'll call you."
Inside the Night Owl, the band wrapped up, good time music, and Sebastian said,
"You folks stay groovy for just a few minutes and we'll be right back."
Somewhere in that elegant pearl gray suit, Dave knew Jake had a couple of joints, and his attention was already in the tiny dressing room downstairs where he and Sebastian would light them up. Harden saw it too.
"I've got a new song," he said.
"You got it on tape?" Jake said.
"I can sing it for you right now. Got myself a red balloon, got a blue surprise."
"You know the deal, Timmy, no tape, no advance."
Dave wanted to hear the rest of the song. Such was the power of Harden's charisma that Dave wondered if he had $50 on him, which he didn't.
"Listen," Jake said, "I've got some business to attend to, but if you're around later, we could do some work tonight."
"Oh man, not tonight. I just got back."
"All right then, later."
Jake nodded to both of them and ducked back in the club. Dave felt abandoned. If Harden noticed his discomfort, he didn't show it.
"Did I ever tell you," Harden said, "about the first time I saw Susan here in the village?"
This was the actress who worked under the name Susan Yardley.
Hardin had met and fallen in love with her in L.A., and she had inspired the sudden outpouring of songs. She was living in this apartment over on Christopher. This must have been 63, and there was a bar there on the ground floor. And I walked in there one day, and she was dancing to the jukebox all by herself. Fly Me to the Moon was playing. God, she was beautiful. I just stood and watched her, never said a word to her. The minute I saw her in L.A., I recognized her. I knew right then it was fate, man. Destiny.
Sinatra, was it? Dave asked.
Sure, man, Sinatra. Who else?
That record just came out last year, August of 64.
Hardin shook his head in disgust. Maybe it was Mathis. Maybe it was last year. You're not hearing what I'm telling you, man. You got no romance in your soul.
If that's true, Dave thought, why do I think of Rachel and cry every time I hear it'll never happen again? And then he thought, what a tissue of lies we all make out of our pasts. Pointed little narratives that prove something. The hand of God or the lack of God, how smart we were or how blind, how funny, how sad.
I've got to meet somebody, Hardin said. Can you loan me $5?
Dave knew where the money would go and still, for no reason that would hold up in daylight, gave him 10.
Hardin responded with a heart-melting smile. Tomorrow, he said. And Dave raised one hand in farewell as he disappeared into the crowd. He briefly considered looking for Jake and Sebastian, then decided he'd had enough of the future for one night. The gaslight was around the corner. Maybe Van Ronk was playing. Early afternoon, the Saturday after Cole's first dinner at the Montoya house, he sat in his parents' living room and waited for Alex to pick him up. Pee-wee Reese and Dizzy Dean were calling a Yankees game on TV. The monotony of their voices hypnotic, sleep-inducing. Cole's father slumped in his recliner with drugstore reading glasses halfway down his nose, sketching some new piece of furniture that he would eventually build in the wood shop in the garage, with Cole's grudging participation in the cleanup, sanding, staining, and all the other parts that his father didn't have the patience for. Cole's mother sat across the room, knitting yet another pair of slipper socks. Alex, being polite, rang the doorbell instead of honking from the driveway. Cole reluctantly brought him inside to run the gauntlet of his father's disapproval.
Mom, Dad, this is Alex.
Cole's father looked at Alex over the top of his glasses.
Jeff says you've been a big help showing him the ropes at school.
It sounded like an accusation.
It was nothing really, sir.
No?
He glanced at Cole as if this confirmed his suspicions. To Alex, he said,
And you play tennis?
I try, sir.
I'm not as good as Jeff.
I see. He stared at Alex as if he expected further confessions.
Cole cleared his throat.
We need to get going, Dad. You're going to be home for supper?
No, I'm eating at Alex's. I already cleared it with Mom. I'll be home by 10.
His father nodded brusquely and looked down at the sketchpad. Cole grabbed the paper bag full of stuff that he'd left by the door and hustled Alex outside.
Holy shit, Alex said. Is he like that all the time?
No, most of the time he's not in such a good mood.
They drove to St. Mark's, where Cole tried to normalize Alex's strokes and get him to follow through. As soon as they started to keep score, Alex reverted.
I don't like to lose, Alex said. I can't help myself.
If you put discipline on top of your natural ability, you'd be really good. You could make the team.
Then I'd really have to get my ass in gear. Don't worry, Cole, you're not responsible.
Still, Alex's occasional efforts at good form threw him off enough for Cole to take both sets, 6-4 and 6-3. Cole tried not to show his disappointment when the red T-bird was not in the driveway, lest Alex give him one of his pained looks. They changed into swim trunks, and Cole swam a few laps to work the kinks out. Then he did a flip turn and rolled over into an easy backstroke.
Don't you ever goof off?
Alex called out to him.
Alex was in the deep end, both arms up on the rough concrete edge of the pool.
At his next turn, Cole hesitated,
hands gripping the edge, feet planted against the tile.
What do you mean?
You know, hang on the edge of the pool and look at the sky.
I never really thought about it.
When he'd tired himself out, Cole made a few simple dives off the board and stayed underwater as long as he could, gliding the length of the pool. In his dreams, he was able to open his mouth and breathe underwater. Later, he showered in the guest bathroom upstairs and changed into clean clothes from his grocery sack. He'd brought the pint-sized Japanese reel-to-reel that had been his last year's Christmas present, and he set it up to record Highway 61 and Bringing It All Back Home. The Rolling Stones' Out of Our Heads and the Animals' Animal Tracks. They sat in the den downstairs while the albums were taping, and Cole tried to get a line on the female situation. He'd heard about an all-girls school called Hockaday that was the distaff St. Mark's.
No, man, Alex said. Hockadaisies are a bunch of stuck-up prudes.
There's going to be a party at Arch Walker's house in a couple of weeks. I'm talking about drama club girls, art girls, music girls, a live band, action guaranteed.
Cole nodded.
Alex said, you're still a virgin, right?
After a silence, Cole said, yeah.
I've been in Midland. Nothing's happening in Midland. You?
Close, Alex said.
Not all the way. Not yet. They'd snuck up a couple of bohemias out of the spare refrigerator in the garage, and Alex took a long drink.
We go down to Guanajuato every Christmas for a week or 10 days. It would be pretty easy to, you know, go with a professional. A lot of my friends down there have done it, but that's not really what I want, you know?
Yeah, Cole said.
I would want to want her to want it too.
Cole went upstairs to turn the record over, and when he came back, he said,
that's why I wanted to go to public school. I've been in Dallas for 4 months, and I haven't even met any girls my age.
Your dad is like my dad, Alex said. He wants you to go further than he did.
And I don't even want to go in the same direction.
Meaningless job and wife and mortgage and car payment.
Yeah? You already know what you want to do?
I've known since I was little.
Tell me.
Cole shook his head.
Nope. If I told you, you'd mock me.
Now you have to tell me. I swear I won't give you shit.
I always wanted to work for the FBI or the CIA, Cole said.
The beer, he thought, was loosening his tongue. Field agent, overseas, undercover, the whole deal.
Like James Bond.
I've read all of those. And John le Carré and Len Deaton and people you've never heard of. Philip McCutcheon, Donald Hamilton, Philip Attlee, and that's just the fiction.
You are seriously into this.
Right now I can only work in Latin America because Spanish is my only other language except for a few words of Arabic. That's why I'm going to take Russian in college.
Do you really think you could kill somebody?
Oh, hell yeah.
I think it would be very satisfying.
Once you were in the middle of it, kill or be killed, no question at all.
Cole, have you ever considered the idea that you might be completely fucked up crazy?
No, Cole said. If it's either me or the rest of the world, I know who I trust.
All that week, Cole put on the Dylan tape as soon as he finished his homework. The walk-in closet in his bedroom was his secret headquarters, furnished with an old armchair and a lamp and a TV tray. He listened to Dylan there to lessen the chance of his father hearing it and going on a tirade. When he sang along, his voice was no more than a whisper. By Saturday night, both albums played continuously in his head. Alex arrived alone in the Monza to pick him up.
I thought Susan was coming, Cole said.
She went with her own friends.
Are you kidding? Why would she want to go with us?
No reason, Cole said.
Never mind.
Moody Coliseum was the SMU basketball court, a red brick box like all the campus buildings. They parked 2 blocks away in a student lot and joined the crowds on the wide flight of concrete steps outside. For all of Cole's father's talk about beatniks and long-haired weirdos, what they mostly saw was short-haired college boys in slacks and sport coats, a few balding guys in black turtlenecks,
some women in their 30s with straight hair halfway down their backs and skirts above their knees, who looked like they'd taxied in from New York. Cole got his ticket out. He'd been carrying it in his billfold all week, and it had started to show some wear. They passed through the big glass doors and followed the signs to the steeply raked seats of Section M. The stage was below them, and to their left, a set of risers with a white cloth backdrop and a rough scaffolding for the lights. He could make out instruments in the dimness of the stage: piano, organ, drums, amplifiers. He had trouble getting his breath. The sight of Susan climbing the steps toward them made him sit up straight and try to look casual at the same time. She was squired by a tall, massive guy in a yellow blazer and a narrow tie that looked like it might choke him. Behind her stood a girl with a blonde flip, cat-eye glasses, and an equally large date. Susan spotted Cole and Alex and waved. Cole smiled and waved back, and watched her settle in, three rows down and a dozen seats past him, eclipsed by her date's bulk. The wooden floor of the basketball court had been covered with a gray canvas tarp and folding chairs, nearly all of them full. The stream of people into the side sections had slowed to a trickle. Expectant silences passed over the crowd, followed by bursts of nervous talk. Cole saw that he was drumming his fingers on the wooden seat between his legs and forced himself to stop. At last, the lights faded. A spotlight picked out the front of the stage, and a disembodied voice introduced Columbia recording artist Bob Dylan. The applause was nearly drowned out by shouts and yelps and whistles. Then Dylan was there, small, not more than 5'8" in his boots, some kind of ultra-modern tan suit with no collar or lapels, hair standing up like a rooster tail, acoustic guitar, harmonica rack. He waited for the applause to fade, and then he leaned toward the mic and said, "Hi." Laughter, more applause. He stroked the guitar strings, and the strokes turned into chords, and he started to sing. "Of war and peace, the truth just twists." Until that moment, Cole had been detached, watching the movie unfold. Now suddenly the reality of it hit him in the solar plexus. He smelled the hair oil of the guy in front of him. He felt the density of the concrete beneath his loafers, heard the PA echo off the rear wall of the Coliseum, saw a kid in the front row of chairs lean forward to put his elbows on his knees. He felt the chill and dampness of the air that lay over the city, the curvature of the earth, the tidal pull of the moon. The piercing notes of the harmonica, Dylan's voice itself, nasal and whiny, his curiously emphatic thee, his chilly distance, all meant more than the tangled symbolism of his lyrics. They were the secret handshake, the tap on the shoulder, the beckoning hand from the alleyway. They separated the curious from the initiated. Toward the end of the acoustic set, a girl with long ironed blonde hair walked slowly out of the center aisle and floated toward the stage as if she'd been hypnotized. She reached out a hand to touch Dylan's boot, and before her fingers made contact, two cops materialized out of the shadows and gently led her away. Dylan finished the set with Desolation Row, a song that Cole was sure nobody else in the audience understood half as well as he did. None of the places he'd ever lived, not the mud brick houses and palm-lined suburbs of Suez, not the pastel-colored plaster walls and oily air of Villa Hermosa, not the blasted salty plains of West Texas, and certainly not the high-rises in miniature mansions and paved-over scrublands of Dallas, had ever felt like home. The only space that the word defined for him was inside himself, a space that Dylan had mapped to the finest detail. The lights came up and Alex asked if he wanted anything. He was talking about getting a Coke, Cole realized. He shook his head. The $4 he'd paid for his ticket had wiped out his allowance. As Alex ran lightly down the steps, Cole wondered what Susan's friends had made of Dylan.
The two boys had stood up and turned to face their dates, brawny arms folded, talking and laughing. Cole willed Susan to turn around and see him, to see that he understood that this was no laughing matter. She resisted his psychic powers, as so many had before her. His awareness kept returning to the stage. Tilted, overlapping circles of drum heads and cymbals, worn guitar necks propped against the silver fabric of the speaker cabinets, cables wrapped like vines around the trunks of microphone stands. Their hum ran up his spine. He was content to be in that fulcrum moment, knowing that once the electric set started, it would be on its way to being over. When Alex finally made it back, he had two Cokes and handed one to Cole.
In case you changed your mind, the lines were really long.
Thanks, man. He took a long drink.
So what did you think?
Cole opened his mouth and nothing came out. He thought of the blonde girl drawn toward Dylan by currents of magnetic force. It was more like that than words.
Yeah, Alex said. Me too.
The lights began to dim. The last voices in the audience fell silent at the same moment that the room went dark. Somebody moved on the stage. Shadows passed in front of the tiny red lights on the amplifiers. The bass drum gave out a single muffled thud. A voice counted to four, and the stage lights came up behind a tidal wave of noise. So loud and so distorted, so garbled by echoes off the hard, flat walls that Cole couldn't distinguish the individual instruments, let alone any semblance of melody or rhythm. Terrifying, exhilarating, uncontainable, triumphant. It blew harmlessly through Cole's body even as it leveled Western civilization around him. Dylan had the same suit on, now under an electric guitar, and the electricity arced through his legs and made him jump stiffly across the stage. He charged the microphone and spat lyrics into it, his expression no longer distantly amused, but aggressive and defiant. He'd been booed, Cole had heard, in New York and L.A., and was clearly expecting it again. Cole felt a chord change more than heard it. And that and the lead guitar riff told him that the song was Tombstone Blues, the second cut on the first side of Highway 61. The chaos of sound clicked into focus, and now he could make out the words and hear the surging Lowry organ and the pummeling bass. Cole had grown up in an era of cowboy shows on television, and despite years without TV in Mexico and Egypt, he'd been obsessed with them, from Wanted Dead or Alive to Have Gun Will Travel to Cheyenne. The iconic pegged jeans, low-slung holster and cartridge belt, hat and vest and boots added up to an image that overshadowed plot and dialogue and character. Dylan's new persona was equally powerful and fit precisely into the absence that the cowboys had left in Cole's imagination. The absence that the secret agents in their anonymous gray suits had never quite filled. Even more compelling was the lead guitarist at Dylan's left hand. Pinstriped jacket and tie, black hair, guitar as blonde as the girl from the audience, half smiling as he leaned into it, not so much creating the music as riding it the way a cowboy would, controlling it with flicks of the wrist, his body rippling with corollary motion. As the song clattered to a close, Cole heard whistles and cheers over the applause, and no boos at all. Cole clapped until his hands hurt. Dylan, more interested in his band than the audience, quickly started another song, Baby Let Me Follow You Down, the Animals rock version instead of the folk version from his first album, an album that hadn't moved Cole when Alex had played it for him. He was moved now. After that came It Ain't Me, Babe, and what had at first been noise was full of melody, not as cheap and accessible as the Italian love songs that Cole had once listened to on KRLD's Music Till Dawn, but all the more intense because of it. Then everything slowed, and Dylan sang, When You're Lost in the Rain in Juarez, and Cole snapped a mental picture to take with him for the rest of his life. Blue lights washing the stage, the giant shadow of the head of the bass guitar on the white backdrop. The drummer and the piano player both hunched over, Dylan wide open to the microphone, the lead guitarist watching him as everyone in the audience was watching him, leaning forward into the song as Cole was, and all of them together surrendering. After that, Like a Rolling Stone, and then Maggie's Farm as encore with Dylan on piano. Not enough, but really everything after that first electric onslaught had been overkill. The damage was done. On Saturday mornings, Steve Cole liked to sleep late, put on his old brown corduroy bathrobe, nearly worn through in the elbows, and listen to Goodman at Carnegie Hall or Ellington at Newport. Betty would make French toast, and then he would get dressed and maybe go out to the wood shop. It was October 2nd, the first seriously cold morning of the fall. As he unfolded the newspaper at the dining room table, he heard the mower running in the front yard. Betty brought him his first cup of coffee, and he said,
"That kid's cutting the grass?"
He said it needed one last trim before winter. He said to tell you he was lowering the blades to strip it.
Steve grunted in satisfaction. Nice not to have to remind the boy for once.
A little early, isn't it?
At this hour, the lawn would still be damp with dew and the bag would get heavy fast.
He's playing tennis later.
With the Mexican kid?
With his friend Alex, yes.
Betty went into the kitchen and a minute later he heard the bacon hiss and pop in the pan. The headline read, "Panel ask pay boost, more Dallas policemen." Steve nodded in silent agreement, wondering where the money would come from. Betty brought in their plates and Steve poured syrup on the French toast.
Did he eat anything?
He had an instant breakfast.
He'd take food pills if he could, like those astronauts of his.
He cut the point off one of the triangles of bread and chewed it slowly. It was slightly underdone. Betty said,
"He brought up the guitar business again this morning."
"Why doesn't he talk to me about it?"
"Why do you think?"
Steve took another bite of French toast and then a bite of bacon that had been lying in the pool of syrup, salt and sweet together.
"He'll get over it."
"I don't think so. Not this time."
"Well, he's going to have to talk to me directly. I don't want to hear any more about it from you. You can tell him that."
He reached for the sports page with his left hand and another piece of bacon with his right. After he finished the yard, the kid changed into tennis shorts and a sweater, and then came and told Steve he needed to talk. Betty was hovering around the living room, pretending to dust and rearrange the magazines on the coffee table.
"I need to drive over to Centennial," Steve said. "Come with me and we can talk in the car."
The kid shrugged.
"Sure, okay."
Dallas was a Baptist city, with antiquated and hypocritical Baptist laws. Blue laws kept most of the stores closed on Sunday, and liquor laws forced bars to resort to the private club dodge, like during Prohibition. North Dallas was dry, which meant you had to drive a couple of miles south and east to the island city of University Park to find a liquor store. As soon as he backed onto the street, Steve said,
"Do you think I like my job?"
He saw he'd thrown the kid for a loop.
"Don't you?" he finally asked. "As a matter of fact, I don't. Oil is filthy, and I can't stand the smell of it. Most of the people I work with are ignorant and crude. Accounting is boring, and I've hated most of the places we've had to live."
"Then why do you do it?"
"Life isn't about what I want to be. It's about making a good living and a job with security and a chance to get ahead. It's about making sure my kid gets opportunities I didn't have to go to a first-rate college.
So I can get a job I hate?" It stung, like the kid had snuck in a good right hand to the face. He took a second to clear his head.
"No," he said. "So you have more choices than I did."
"What did you want to be?"
"What? You mean did I want to be a movie star or a big game hunter or pitch for the Dodgers? That's kid stuff. By the time I got out of the army, I was married to your mother, and all I wanted was a job where I could make enough to get us a place of our own and get away from the fold-out bed at your Grandpa Mac's."
What about before you went in?
Steve hesitated. He didn't like to talk about it. On the other hand, this was the first time the kid had attempted a real conversation since puberty.
I wanted to fly. I tried to volunteer before Pearl, but I was too young. I turned 18 in June of 42, and they took me into the Air Corps. Then it came out that I had had some epilepsy attacks when I was a kid. Nothing since I was 3 years old, but they had their rules and they washed me out before I got my wings. That's when they put me in accounting.
How come you never told me?
It doesn't help to talk about it. There's different kinds of happiness. One kind is where you do your job well and take care of your family, and people know they can count on you.
I don't think that's a useful definition of happiness for a 15-year-old kid.
You have to think about your future happiness, not just scratching whatever itch you have at the moment. If you don't think ahead, if you don't have a plan, you'll end up broke on some street corner with pencils and a tin cup.
Or with a guitar?
Steve looked him over. No smirk, no challenge, no indication that he was smarting off. Or with a guitar, he agreed.
Your mother told me. What do you want a guitar for?
Alex and I are going to start a combo.
Who's Alex?
Something about the way the kid expected him to remember everybody's name made him contrary.
I play tennis with him. Have eaten dinner over there? We went to the concert together?
Concert? Since when is some beatnik wailing a concert?
The kid was struggling to keep his patience, and Steve let him stew for a while. Finally, the kid said,
I want this, Dad. I want it more than I've ever wanted anything.
If you had one, how do you know you'd be able to play it? How do you know you won't get tired of it in 2 weeks and go on to something else?
I've played Alex's guitar. I can learn. It was like I already knew how and I was just remembering it.
Steve let the silence unwind for a while before he said,
How much does it cost?
We went looking after school this week. We found just what I want at a pawn shop on Harry Hines. For everything. The guitar, a practice amp, a case, a 12-foot cord, a strap, an extra set of strings, and a half dozen picks.
He took a deep breath.
$125.
Amp?
Yeah, a practice amplifier. It's about this big.
He pantomimed a shape a bit larger than a shoebox.
You're talking about an electric guitar?
The kid was losing his temper, as he always did, though he tried to hide it.
Of course, to play in a group.
Steve shook his head.
Now, one of those Spanish guitars, I could maybe see that, but electric?
The kid went quiet, and Steve took another look. He had his jaw set and was wearing an expression of defiance that Steve had never seen before. At that instant, Steve knew he was standing on the edge of a cliff. In the next 30 seconds, he could lose his son, maybe for good. The thought made him so furious that he was tempted to press on, not only refuse the guitar, but ground him for picking one out before he had permission, for announcing that he was going to be in a combo with the Mexican kid like it was already decided. Lock him in his room if he had to. If Steve had tried to blackmail his own father this way, even at age 15, he would have gotten a beating, probably with a razor strop. And if he'd fought back, his father would have gone after him with his fists and beaten hell out of him. He'd sworn he wouldn't be that kind of father. He'd also assumed his son would be like Steve was at that age, quiet, hardworking, obedient. His window of opportunity to preserve his family was closing. He tried to clear the rage from his throat, found he couldn't, cleared it again. Looking straight at the road in front of him, he said,
Give me a minute to think about it.
They drove the rest of the way in silence. Steve parked and said,
Coming in?
And got only a surly shake of the head in reply. He took his time. He picked up a fifth of Bacardi white rum for Betty and a fifth of Canadian Club for himself, then lingered for a while looking at the imported beers. This will pass, he told himself, like the kid's obsession with cowboy shows and toy six-shooters. And then he saw the way to turn this to his own advantage, and it was all he could do to keep from whistling as he walked out. He drove back to Northwest Highway and said,
"Okay, here's the deal. If you want this, it's gonna cost you. I'll front you the money for the guitar, but you have to pay it back."
"Of course."
"Wait till I'm finished. You have to pay it back from what you'll earn in your summer job next year working in the oil fields in Tyler."
"All summer?"
"2 months."
"Okay." Steve was stunned. He'd underestimated how far the kid was willing to go.
"I'll draw up a contract, which you'll have to sign so there's no misunderstanding. There are two other conditions. The first is you have to keep up a B average at school. If that slips, you lose a guitar."
"Okay."
"The second one is this. You can play in his combo with your Mexican friend, but this is not going to be your career. I am not going to provide you with the tools to throw away your education and wind up using dope and living with Negroes and getting syphilis and dying at age 30 in some rat hole. This is a hobby, and nothing more than that. Is that understood?"
It occurred to Steve that he might have pushed too far. So be it. He'd lived through the Depression and seen the despair in men's eyes who only wanted work, any kind of work, and couldn't find it. He'd been stationed in Europe for the last year of the war and seen how they lived over there, the bombed out cities, people eating their own wallpaper. He, and every man he'd served with, had been determined to build a world where that would never happen to them, and they'd done it. Now that there was prosperity, maybe it was all too easy. He didn't want to admit it, but it hurt him. "Here is this gift," he'd said to his son. "Here is the world I made for you, a world where you can be assured of a good job and a good living, your own home, your own car, enough money to raise a family. I worked all my life to make you this world." And his son said, "No, I don't want that. It's worth nothing to me. What I want is an electric guitar." They pulled up at a light, and Steve turned to face him.
"Well?
How long do I have? Since we're laying all this out, do I have until I finish college to play in bands? And that has to include playing in public because there's no point otherwise."
"Assuming you keep up your grades, I suppose so."
The kid licked his lips. "Okay, then."
"Not good enough. I need to hear you say, 'I agree.'"
"I agree," the kid said. Steve bit back the words his own father had used so many times about how it was for his own good. "Take your bitter victory," he told himself, "and show a little class."
"Good," Steve said. "Now, where is this pawn shop?"
Dave had tagged along to San Francisco with Jake in the Spoonful, and what he'd found there was a city shedding its skin. The old city was North Beach. The tawdry burlesque joints and the beat bookstores and coffee houses, where the band was currently wrapping up a 2-week residency at the Hungry Eye, a folk and comedy club that was not remotely prepared to deal with their volume or the quantity of their recently converted fans. The new thing was Haight-Ashbury, a Victorian neighborhood recently saved from the wrecking ball, now home to a cultural ferment so new that it didn't have a name. Their unofficial ambassador was one Luria Castell, a dark-haired entrepreneur in thrift store couture and glasses, a founding member of something called the Family Dog, which had been involved in a rock dance scene that summer at the Red Dog Saloon in Virginia City. Luria had discovered the Spoonful at the Trip in LA, and during their previous San Francisco residency, at a club called Mother's, she had brought the Haight-Ashbury royalty to see them. Her partner, Chet Helms, a comedy ensemble called The Committee, and another theater group called The Mime Troupe, along with their loud and headstrong manager, a New Yorker named Bill Graham. Now Luria had booked the Spoonful for a dance at the Longshoremen's Hall on the Sunday after the Hungry Eye gig, touted as the sequel to a dance the previous Saturday called A Tribute to Doctor Strange that the Cognoscenti were still talking about. Those same scene makers and dozens of hip, artsy, extroverted kids from the Haight had been showing up every night to shake hands and share a joint or two with the guys in the band. Because the guys already knew their way around, from Carol Doda's famous artillery shell silicone-injected breasts on exhibit every night at the Condor, to the Roaring Twenties and its infamous girl on the swing routine, they dove headlong into the decadence. Everything they had worked so hard for was now theirs, not by the spoonful, but by the truckload. Adulation, sex, and at least the promise of wealth, though no actual money had yet arrived from the record label. What with the brazen availability of the girls in the audience, the seediness of the neighborhood, the excitement of the hit record, and the width of the continent between them and home, the boys were swept into a carnal frenzy that Dave was embarrassed to behold. Jake was no help. He'd loved the city since he'd attended a jamboree there as a Boy Scout and was out sightseeing all day in a rented car. Dave had taken to roaming the streets of North Beach at night, browsing its city lights or lingering over an espresso at Cafe Trieste. The hustle, flashing neon, the loneliness of the commodified sex, all left him alienated and blue. Then, on the final Friday, he saw Hugh Romney's name on a flyer outside the Committee's Theater on Broadway, a few doors down from the Hungry Eye. Dave had spoken to Romney a few times in the village, fascinated by the dizzying wordplay that brought on intellectual and moral aftershocks. Lenny Bruce, who was managing Romney at the time, had carried him off to L.A. in 1962 and made him the first of a wave of defectors that eventually included Jim McGuinn and David Crosby. Though the evening show was over, the doors of the theater were unlocked. The place had steeply raked seats and a big open stage. A strange-looking guy with a long, narrow face and an enormous nose asked him his business.
"My name is Dave Fisher. I was hoping to see Hugh."
"Wait here." A minute later, Hugh appeared in dungarees and a sweater. Dave barely recognized him without his trademark finery.
"Hey, I know you," Hugh said. "Dave, is it?"
"Yeah, I used to come see you at the Gaslight."
"Right, how you doing?"
Dave never felt awkward around Hugh, who radiated a fearless comfort with his own existence. And after a little small talk, Hugh consented to a cup of coffee.
"I'm just up from L.A. for a couple of days,"
Hugh said as they settled in at the counter of an all-night diner.
"I'm trying to pick up a buck or two. I used to be a member of this outfit, so I guess I'm remembering. I've got a day job teaching improv to actors at Columbia Pictures back home, but I'm part of this commune type thing now, and we go through a lot of money."
"A commune? For real?"
"Yeah, a bunch of the pranksters got stranded in L.A. You know about the pranksters?"
"I guess I've heard of them."
"Bunch of weirdos. Do a lot of acid. Real LSD freaks. We're all living on this hog farm and doing crazy stuff on Sundays for anybody that comes up."
"I can't picture you on a hog farm.
You were always so debonair." "That's kitchen synchronicity for you. Always making you get a new set of plots and plans. There's change to spare these days, and the hog farm is in the thicket of it. And the real epicenter is here in Frisco."
Hugh waved one hand at their rundown surroundings.
"Not here, not in North Beach, but over in the Hate, or at these things they're doing at the Longshoreman's Hall."
Dave told him about the upcoming Spoonfill gig.
"Aha, you'll see for yourself then. I'd be there, but I've got to get back to L.A., back to the farm. I got married, you know."
He seemed amazed.
"She's an actress. She's smart and beautiful and sensible. We've got nothing in common."
He smiled hugely.
"Except empathy. We're having a mad, compassionate love affair."
"Congratulations," Dave said.
"I think the next thing that happens is that we take this show and tell on the road. We're preaching to the convertibles in L.A. Can you imagine what they'll make of us in Peoria?"
When they stood up to leave, Hugh startled Dave by hugging him.
"I've got to get back," he said. "I'm so glad to see you again. I love surprises. They're the proving ground for philosophy."
On Sunday afternoon, a young woman from the family dog arrived in a 1940s pickup to carry the Spoonful's equipment down to the Longshoreman's Hall. She was fresh-faced and auburn-haired, wearing a plaid shirt with the sleeves rolled up and battered Levi's. Zal immediately claimed the passenger seat, leaving Dave to ride in the back with the gear. The sun had finally broken through, raising the temperature into the 70s, and as they barreled downhill, Dave saw the Golden Gate to his left and the Bay Bridge to his right. Straight ahead, across the deep blue of the bay, were the rugged hills of Marin County. This, then, was what Jake had fallen for. This supernatural beauty that grounded the weirdness and poetry and sexual license in an earthly paradise. The hall itself was an octagonal concrete bunker with a high domed roof. As the band attempted a sound check, Dave walked around the immense echoing space without finding a single point where the acoustics were less than horrendous. They gave up and went their separate ways, Zali disappearing with the girl in the pickup. When Dave returned at 8 that night, banners painted on bedsheets announced a tribute to Sparkle Plenty, with renderings of the ingenue from the Dick Tracy comic strip. What must have been 1,000 kids filled the room, dressed as cowboys, soldiers, 19th century aesthetes, hobos, knights, princesses, and deep sea divers. In New York, rebel kids had hair that covered the tops of their ears and maybe spilled over their collars. Here, some of the boys had not cut their hair in years, letting it flow past their shoulders or corkscrew out in Caucasian afros. These kids had none of the attitude that was mandatory in New York, the boasting, the strutting, the competing for attention. Instead, they glided wide-eyed and smiling from one embrace to the next, passing around joints, wine, flowers, and fruit. The air was thick with pot and cigarette smoke, sandalwood incense, patchouli oil, English leather. Jake beamed as if he'd been airlifted to Valhalla. "Every one of these people," he announced, "is stoned or tripping or both. How fantastic is that?"
"I don't know, Jake," Dave said. "You tell me."
Jake had told him how he'd done acid after seeing Leary and Alpert in New York the year before, having bought some blotters in the lobby along with a copy of The Psychedelic Experience. He had gotten all he needed from a few trips, though he periodically urged Dave to try it so he could work on the bardos of his own existence. Jake was also excited about seeing the opening act, the Charlatans, who'd been the house band at the Red Dog in Nevada. Luria Castell had brought him photos and a cassette at the trip in L.A., and Jake had been intrigued by the looks they affected. Victorian dandies, cowboys, riverboat gamblers. The kind of old-timey clothes that Jake himself loved, taken to the extreme to the point of wearing loaded six guns on stage. Things got off to a slow start. First came shtick from a local DJ, followed by a lot of drug jokes from the long-faced committee guy Dave had run into at the theater. The crowd got restless, wanting to dance, and the committee guy got hustled off to make room for the Charlatans. Once they finally got going, their sound was so muddy that Dave couldn't tell much about them. They switched off lead vocals, and the songs were all over the place, from blues and jug band to folk and rock, none of them memorable. The audience didn't share Dave's concerns. They began to dance at the first drum beat, a whole different kind of dancing than Dave had ever seen, more sway than bounce, with no concern for pairing one woman with one man. The point was to make a personal statement, to do something nobody else was doing. One guy in pajamas did the backstroke across the floor, pushing himself forward with his legs. The other dancers, if they noticed him, gave him room. Jake, grinning, waded out onto the floor. A blonde girl in an Indian headband, complete with feather, beckoned Dave to join her. Blushing, he waved her off. The last time he'd danced was the hora at his bar mitzvah. As he watched dancers attach and detach, forming singles and couples and groups, it gradually occurred to him that this was more than a new way of dancing. More than LSD, more than a new style of music, more than a few kids in an outpost of weirdness on the West Coast. "Change to spare," Hugh had said. By the time Hugh and his prankster friends got to Peoria, Dave thought, it was going to be a tidal wave. Dave was paging through the in-flight magazine on the plane to New York when Jake said, "What do you think?"
"I think maybe I'm too old," Dave said.
He had in fact turned 30 a few weeks before, the age at which he was no longer to be trusted, according to the radicals at Berkeley. He'd taken himself out for a solitary dinner to celebrate.
"Bullshit," Jake said. "You're just uptight. You need to work on your bardos of existence."
"You were into it."
"I was glad to see people loosen up. And, not to be cynical, there is money to be made with dances like that. Put them in a proper ballroom with decent acoustics, it could be gigantic."
He spread Luria's photos of the charlatans on his folding tray. "What do you think of these guys?"
"Not much," Dave said. In retrospect, something about them had put him off. A smugness that bordered on sarcasm.
"The gal, Luria Castell, she wants me to produce some demos on them." Dave noted the first person singular.
"Are you gonna do it?"
"Something's happening out there," Jake said.
"Yeah.
Yeah, I think I am." Madeline turned away from her locker to find two boys looming over her. One was Ed Wallingford, from her civics class, and the other, whose name she didn't remember, played football. Ed had serious acne problems and a tendency to become tongue-tied when called upon. The football player did not appear to be emotionally engaged.
"We're supposed to give you this note," Ed said.
Madeline, rattled, was reluctant to accept it.
"Who's it from?"
"Billy Dixon," Ed said.
He sounded irritable, as if Madeline should somehow have already known.
"Billy Dixon?"
Madeline said. Billy was a track star and dreamily handsome. He was too good a student and too introverted to be in the first rank of popular boys, but he was high in the second tier.
"What does he want with me?"
Ed thrust the note at her again.
"Why don't you read it and find out?"
"Dear Madeline," the note read. She noted the misspelling and didn't take points off, being too used to it. "I think you are really cool, but I'm shy to talk to you in person. I think maybe you might think I'm just a dumb jock and not want to know me, which is okay, I would understand. But if you would like to go to the Halloween dance on Saturday, maybe you could tell Ed and he would pass it on to me. I hope you will say yes, Billy." Flattered, skeptical, and flummoxed, she read the note a second time and had started a third when Ed said,
"Well?
Can I think about it?"
Ed looked at the football player incredulously.
"Billy Dixon wants to go out with her and she has to think about it?"
Madeline had no idea what to say, so she panicked and said the thing that was expected.
"Well then, yes, I suppose."
"You suppose?"
"Yes then," Madeline said. "Yes."
Madeline's parents were skeptical too, though not nearly as much so as her sister Julia. Julia was 2 years younger and more conventionally pretty than Madeline. She had short, nearly natural blonde hair where Madeline's was red gold and halfway down her back, breasts that had filled out much earlier and much further than Madeline's, a pout that was more studied than spontaneous, and none of Madeline's off-putting vocabulary. The boys in her freshman class were already chasing her, and Madeline worried that Julia was not running nearly fast enough.
"Why would anybody popular want to go out with you?" Julia asked. "Does he need help with his homework?" "He's pretty bright, actually," Madeline said, which would also answer your first question.
"How far are you going to let him go?"
"What?"
Madeline had spoken in shock. Julia took it, perhaps willfully, for ignorance.
"On a first date, I don't think you should let him get past second base outside your clothes. In any case, you need to make up your mind before and stick to it."
Madeline had not considered the issue. She was not completely without experience, although her prior dates had involved a parent or two as chauffeurs and chaperones, boys with bad posture and or glasses, a few sweaty and awkward dances in an echoing gym, and halting conversation in between. Whenever possible, she had double-dated with her best friend Hope, so she'd have someone to talk to. The invitation had been extended on a Monday with the dance that Saturday, neither time nor money was available for an elaborate costume. Madeline's mother helped her go through 2 trunks worth of old clothes in the attic, where they turned up a blue short-sleeved dress, a white apron, and a sufficiency of petticoats to produce a reasonable facsimile of the John Tenniel drawings of Alice. Madeline already had the black Mary Janes, and she added a black domino mask for a hint of mystery. "Dorothy from Wizard of Oz?" Julia hazarded when she saw the finished product. When Madeline explained, Julia said, "Nobody is going to guess that, not in a million years." The arrangement, brokered by Ed, was that Billy would pick her up at 8 at her parents' house. Only at 8:15 did Madeline realize that she had no phone number for Billy and no contingency plans. By 8:45, she understood that he wasn't coming. They were all sitting in the living room pretending to watch NBC's Saturday Night at the Movies. Madeline could not have said what the movie was. Now and then her parents exchanged a worried look or glanced at her. Finally, Madeline stood up and said, "Daddy, would you drive me to the dance?" In preparation for meeting Billy, he was already dressed in a short-sleeved white shirt and black tie. At the gym, he retired to the parents' corner where cookies, ashtrays, and a pot of coffee had been provided. Considerable effort had been expended to decorate the gym with fake cobwebs and cardboard ghosts. The band was on break, the dance floor empty. Madeline knew that neither Hope nor any of her other friends were coming. She told herself the domino mask would provide her anonymity. In fact, she knew that she was already invisible in her plainness, in her failure to compete socially, in her perceived braininess. She kept to the shadows until she saw Billy Dixon. He was with one of the cheerleaders, and they had circled up with other members of the track team and their dates. Madeline watched him for 10 minutes while the band got up on the stacked risers and started to play again. Eventually, Billy took his date's hand and moved toward the dance floor. Madeline triangulated an interception point and contrived to bump into him as if by accident. From his utter lack of embarrassment, she saw that he was not party to the scheme. The notes then had been forged. She and Billy both apologized, and Madeline turned to go. Ed and half a dozen members of various sports teams had lined up along the rear wall of the gym to watch. Ed was smirking, and one of the others was straining so mightily to keep from laughing that his eyes bulged. Madeline took care not to let her expression change as she walked by. Driving home, her father said, "I'm sure I know the answer to this already, but I have to ask. You didn't do anything to Ed, even inadvertently, to trigger this incident?" "No, Daddy." She paused, then said, "He's in my civics class. He's struggling."
"Ah."
They drove for a while in silence. Then he said, "I think you were very brave to show up at that dance. I'm proud of you."
"Thank you, Daddy."
She stared out the window at the street-lit lawns of Highland Park, their dead leaves all raked and bagged and carted away, left with no cover for the coming winter. She was determined not to cry over having been deprived of something she hadn't wanted in the first place. There would be laughter at her expense on Monday, and that would be the hardest part. That much she had coming, she thought, for being so naive. As soon as they got home, she put on her pajamas and got into bed with the Andrew Odyssey and turned to book one. "Tell me, O Muse," she read, and the rest of the world went away. The next afternoon, she borrowed the station wagon to drive to Hope's house. Hope had the twin afflictions of intelligence and excessive height. At 5'11", she had learned that basketball players, the only boys who tolerated the latter, tended to be intimidated by the former.
"I'm through with boys,"
Hope announced, once they were in her room with the door closed. Madeline, having told her on the phone about her humiliation, assumed this diatribe was at least partly in her honor.
I'm through playing dumb to get dates. I'm through having boys rub their hands on me like I was a towel.
Well, Madeline said, nobody wiped his hands on me.
They might as well have. They felt they had the right to play their stupid games with you. You remember that Leslie Gore song?
Madeline did. Nonetheless, Hope rummaged through a vinyl carrying case, pulled out a black-labeled 45 of You Don't Own Me, and sang along at considerable volume with a clenched fist intensity that left Madeline feeling as if her own suffering had been unfairly appropriated.
Afterward, Hope said, It's true, you know. We are the property of our fathers, who loan us out to various boys until the official transfer of ownership when they walk us down the aisle at our weddings.
I don't think my father feels that way about me.
No? What about all those reading lists and quizzes he gives you? You're like a...
Like a what?
Madeline said frostily.
Nothing. I hope you weren't going to say, like a trained dog.
It is a little weird, that's all.
Madeline stood up.
Thanks, Hope. I'll keep that in mind.
Wait, Hope said. I'm sorry. I love your dad. You know I do.
Eventually, she let Hope talk her down, and they returned to Ed Wallingford and how Madeline was going to deal with him. They agreed on silence and a confident smile, which Madeline rehearsed in Hope's mirror until she had it pat. Upon leaving Hope's house, however, the sting in Hope's insult returned. Was everything she did just to please her father? Where did that end and Madeline's own desires begin? The truth was that she didn't know.
. 1966. On a Sunday morning in the middle of June, Cole's parents dropped him off at the Tyler Motor Inn. Whitewash over a plywood exterior, a standard tourist court layout thrown together on the cheap for losers in transit. East Texas Crude Inc. got a weekly rate. Alex had warned him.
Talk about armpits, he'd said. It's 1952 there. They're still crying about Hank Williams and waiting to see if Eisenhower got elected.
Cole had no option but to make the best of it. No distractions, he'd said. More time to practice. Watching his parents drive away, he felt more elated than abandoned. His own place for the first time in his life. A working air conditioner and maid service every Monday. As long as he kept the volume down, he could play guitar all night. Or as long as he could stay awake. In his first full week on the job, that hadn't been much past 9 p.m. The work so far had been easy enough. He was too inexperienced to be on the drilling table with the roughnecks, the really dangerous job. Instead, he cleaned up and carried and used his new driver's license to run errands in a pickup that was the same age as he was, held together with coat hanger wire and coats of battleship gray army surplus paint. What left him lightheaded and stumbling was the damp, choking heat, the noise of the drill, the long hours on his feet. After a half day on the rig Saturday morning, he was fresh out of the shower and looking forward to a steak and a few beers with two of his coworkers. He sat up in bed with his guitar and opened a loose-leaf notebook that had the name Chevelle's painstakingly lettered on the canvas cover. Alex had picked the name, and he'd invested in a Gibson EBO bass guitar and Fender Bassman amp. He'd also recruited a veteran rhythm guitar and keyboard player named Mike Moss from Richardson High. Mike had met with him and Alex just once, in late May, at Alex's house. They'd sat around with guitars and tried their voices together, and Alex had taught them the three-part harmony to Look Through Any Window by the Hollies to see what they were capable of. The process took nearly an hour, and when they were done, they sounded so much like the record that it amazed them all. It changed something in Cole. The way he held himself, the way he saw the world, he felt initiated, powerful. It happened again when he and Alex made it all the way through The Last Time by the Stones, and Cole got all the lead parts note for note. All the songs in all the world were his to command. He and Mike and Alex had put together the list that now made up the first four pages of the notebook. 4 45-minute sets, totaling 60 songs. They'd started with Dylan, the reason the band existed. They'd quickly settled on Mr. Tambourine Man, It Ain't Me, Babe, and Just Like Tom Thumb's Blues, which they knew they would have to shorten the way the Birds had shortened Mr. Tambourine Man. Then it had been a free-for-all, all three of them calling out titles faster than Alex could write them down. After that, they'd gone over the initial list and filled in the gaps, coming up with break songs, slow songs, the obligatory songs like Gloria and Land of a Thousand Dances, relegating the Kinks and Beatles and Stones and Animals to no more than one song per set. The one unexpected argument had been over Richie Valens' La Bamba. Alex didn't want to do it.
"Are you kidding?" Cole had said. "When you and me both speak Spanish?"
"Yo también," Mike said. "That's exactly the reason," Alex said. "I don't want us getting typecast."
"From one song?" Cole said.
"Every band in Texas does La Bamba," Mike said. Eventually, Alex had given in, but it reminded Cole that whenever he said something in Spanish, whether from habit or as a test, Alex always replied in English, never making an issue of it and never going along. The rest of the book was lyrics and chords, some of which Cole was still figuring out. Alex was doing about half the lead vocals, Cole a third, and Mike the rest. By the time Cole got back in mid-August, Mike and Alex were supposed to have found a drummer and started rehearsals. Cole sprinted through Walk, Don't Run and House of the Rising Sun to warm up, still not getting his arpeggios as smooth as he wanted. Then he skipped around the list, ignoring the easy ones like Louie Louie and You Really Got Me, working his way up to Do You Believe in Magic, where the guitar part was tricky enough even without the harmony part he had to sing behind it. In the 8 months he'd been playing, his hands had become the hands of a completely different person. Not just the calluses on the tips of the fingers of his left hand, not just the strength and flexibility. The intelligence behind his playing had moved from his conscious brain into the fingers themselves. He no longer had to listen to know how far to bend a note, rarely had to look down to find the right fret. Standing around at work, he would press his left thumbnail into the thick pads of callus or bend his ring finger into a barred A against his thumb, the way a bodybuilder might flex and pose in front of a mirror. His ears had changed, too. He could hear major sevenths on the radio, hear the 1-4-5 progressions behind most of the songs, hear a note and put his finger on the guitar neck at the place where it lived. He begrudged the years he'd spent doing anything else. He got in a couple of hours of solid practice before he had to get ready, dress Levi's in a brand new green plaid pearl snap western shirt he'd bought at Shepler's in Dallas for camouflage. His work boots were too muddy to wear, so he made do with his loafers. A car honked outside. He checked himself in the mirror and was okay with it. The sun had dried out the two zits on his chin and no new ones had come up yet. His hair had started to grow out and the hard work had straightened his spine. Jerry and Donald, he noted, wore variants of his shirt and jeans. They laughed and whistled, however, as he walked out to Jerry's black Ford Falcon.
"Where'd you get them shoes, college boy?" Donald said as Cole climbed in the back seat.
Donald was the driller on Cole's rig, in his mid-20s, a bit heavy and already losing his hair.
"Jer, we got time to get this boy some proper footwear before dinner?"
"I don't see how we got much choice," Jerry said.
Jerry was the same age as Donald, tall and lean and cooked by the sun. He kept a battered straw hat pulled low over his eyes and a lucky strike in the corner of his mouth. He was the derrick man, working high in the scaffolding when they took the pipe in and out of the hole and monitoring the drilling mud the rest of the time.
"You and me might could suffer for being seen with him in such a disgraceful condition."
They'd been paid in cash that morning, and Cole had $50 in his pocket.
"Let's do it," he said.
He resisted their efforts to get him into ostrich skin or caiman belly Lucchese's, and settled on a plain pair of fries with a walking heel. He felt like the bones in his feet were cracking when he put them on, though they felt fine once he was in them. They set him back $25, which the clerk said was an investment.
They'll last a lifetime if you break them in right. Don't spend too many hours in them at first.
What do you think, Jer?
Donald asked as they walked to the car.
Better, Jerry said. Needs a hat.
Maybe next week, Cole said. Gringo's steakhouse was full of smoke, some from cigarettes, the rest from grilling meat. Cole ordered a ribeye rare and took more kidding over that.
Should have brung my sunglasses, Donald said when the platter arrived. I never did like the sight of blood.
Go easy with that knife, Jerry said. I think I heard her moo.
Though Cole had never been much of an eater, he had no trouble putting away a 12-ounce ribeye, home fries, salad, Texas toast, and a quart of iced tea. By the time he'd gotten on the outside of all that food, he was ready for a nap. Donald had other ideas.
Wagon wheel?
He said as he pushed back from the table.
Wagon wheel, Jerry said.
What's a wagon wheel? Cole asked. The wagon wheel was a gigantic metal shed with tables salvaged from cable spools, rickety folding chairs, and a layer of peanut hulls over the concrete floor to catch the spills. The high ceiling made the level of tobacco smoke somewhat less toxic than at Gringo's. A row of carpet samples separated the tables from the dance floor that ran the length of the shed, and the dancers used it to wipe the peanut hulls off their feet. Cole had never seen that kind of dancing before. The couples faced each other as they circled the outside of the floor, the man's right wrist on the woman's left shoulder, opposite hands clasped. The better dancers glided like they were on ice skates, the women spinning almost continuously. Both sexes wore cowboy hats and jeans and boots and western shirts, though the jeans, Cole noticed immediately, fit one sex much more tightly than the other. A DJ provided the music from a long table at one end of the floor, alternating between two turntables and blasting the result out of a pair of Voice of the Theaters. The songs were vaguely familiar from Midland, where country music permeated the air as thoroughly as the smell of the refineries.
If I was to buy you a beer, Donald said, having to shout over the music, would you know what to do with it?
Lone Star Longnecks were what was available. I believe the narrow end goes in my mouth, Cole said.
See there, Jer? I told you the boy was edumacated.
College boy, Jerry nodded.
Cole had given up his attempts to explain his actual academic status. Donald bought the first round, two each for him and Jerry, one for Cole. Ice chips still clung to the bottles, and the beer was so cold that it tasted like nothing at all. Cole watched the women glide by. Some were overweight, overage, or both. Many were neither. In the course of the next hour, a few roughnecks stopped by the table for shouted pleasantries that, between the background noise and the nearly consonant-free East Texas accents, Cole found unintelligible. He smiled and nodded, watched the dancers, and listened to what the guitar players did on the records. Cole was looking the other way when a voice said,
"Evening, boys,"
followed immediately by the sound of two pairs of boots hitting the floor as Donald and Jerry straightened up in their chairs. The voice came from a dark-eyed blonde in a straw cowboy hat, whose brim was curled as tight as Cole's toes at the sight of her. She wore a man's long-sleeved white shirt with the sleeves rolled up and the tails tied in a knot below her breasts, exposing a flat, tanned stomach and a pair of cut-off jeans that had frayed right up to the point where her long legs joined the rest of her body. She couldn't have been more than 20 and was probably a good deal less. She had one hand on Donald's shoulder and the other on Jerry's, and she was looking at Cole.
"I'm Karina," she said.
"Cole," he said, standing up to reach across the table to take her hand.
"Have a seat. I'll find us another one."
He held his chair for her while she walked around the table and sat down.
"Damn," Donald said. "Is that how they do it in college?"
It took him three tries to find a table with an empty chair. Can I borrow this? Cole asked. The three men at the table were huge, one with a heavy beard, another with a jagged scar on his lip.
We're using it, said the bearded one.
The one with the scar tilted his head toward Cole's table.
Think the boy wants it for Karina.
Hell, take it then.
Thanks, Cole said. He set the chair down far enough from her not to crowd her, not too much anyway.
What college you go to? Karina asked.
UT, Cole said. And then, his conscience pricking him, in about a year and 3 months. That got a more convincing smile out of her.
You don't look like a roughneck.
Summer job? He moved closer so as not to have to shout quite so loudly. For another 57 days, not that I'm counting.
You don't look much like a roughneck either.
The ends of her mouth turned down in something between a grimace and a pout.
Thanks, she said.
Cole figured her for smarter than she was letting on. She was alive in the moment anyway, not on autopilot like most of the women in the room. The DJ played a new song, one that Cole recognized. 6 Days on the Road, Dave Dudley.
Do you dance?
Karina asked.
Not like this, he said.
She grabbed his hand and stood up.
First time for everything. It's not that hard.
Go get her, college boy,
Donald called as Cole stood up. Torn between lust and the terror of humiliating himself, he let himself get drawn toward the dance floor. She leaned in and talked into his ear.
Right hand here. Hold my hand here with your left. Start on your left foot and just walk.
She timed her words to the music.
Left, right, left. Right, left, right, left.
The floor was only half full. She pulled him into an opening and counted him in. Cole did as he was told. In a few seconds, he got the feel of it and tried to smooth it out, to not lift his feet so high. The song was not that fast and he could feel the beat.
Not bad, she said. When I say now, lift your left hand.
Now. He lifted his hand and she spun around twice. Watching her made him lose the rhythm, but when she was facing him again, she was already mouthing the steps. A few seconds later, she picked his right hand off her shoulder and put it into her own right hand and turned herself 1.5 times. Now her back was to him and she was wiggling the fingers of her left hand. Cole picked it up and they danced side by side. The length of her left upper arm pressing against his chest and abdomen, her hat poking him in the shoulder. Chanting the steps under his breath, Cole watched the other leaders around him, and when she turned again, he changed hands on his own and got a big smile for it. He waited a few beats, then lifted his left hand and gave her a push with the right.
I like the initiative, she said. A little gentler next time. And wait for the second slow step.
They made it through the rest of the song without anyone getting hurt, and she said,
There, that wasn't so bad, was it?
No, he said, but you did everything.
That's okay, as long as you let me.
You didn't fight me, and that's a good thing. The DJ said,
And now a slow one for Karina. How you doing, sugar?
She blew an exaggerated kiss to the DJ and then said to Cole,
Now you get your reward.
The DJ played Eddie Arnold's Make the World Go Away. This Cole knew how to do. Karina took her hat off and let it dangle from her left hand where it rested on his shoulder. She moved in until she was brushing gently against him, and Cole didn't pull her any closer than that. He couldn't remember why he'd disliked country music. The violins overflowed with emotion and the piano notes rang sweet and true. He swayed in place during the clean breaks at the start of every verse where he could feel the breath move in and out of her. By the time the song ended, he'd lost all sense of time and space.
Maybe, he said, we could, yes?
She looked pleased with herself.
Get a breath of fresh air? Talk for a minute without having to shout?
She put her hat on.
All right.
As he walked toward the front door, he felt like every man in the room was watching him. In fact, he thought, they probably were. The outside air was hot, but it moved around and it smelled of pine trees. A haze softened the stars and crickets creaked in the distance.
New boots? She asked.
Nah, I've had them nearly 4 hours now. How old are you anyway?
You should know better than to ask a lady her age.
It's important. I'm trying to figure out if I should try to kiss you or not.
If you have to ask, the answer is definitely no.
What do you do then?
Maybe I can get a hint from your occupational status.
I, it would seem, am a year ahead of you. I graduated from Robert E. Lee High School last month and am currently at loose ends, living with my mama and hoping to get accepted into Vista in the fall.
Vista?
It's like a domestic peace corps. I will be helping to fight with the president's war on poverty, though I am not far from that state myself. My mama can't afford to send me to college, and I desperately need to get out of this place.
I'm going to make a wild guess that your yearbook lists drama club under your activities.
Why, however, did you deduce that?
Her deep South accent was credible.
Blanche DuBois in Streetcar. Ado Annie in Oklahoma.
The girl who can't say no, Cole said. I like you better by the minute. They had arrived at Jerry's Falcon. The doors proved to be locked.
Yours?
Karina asked.
Jerry's.
We can sit on the hood and I can take a load off these boots.
Can't live with them. Can't two-step without them.
She hopped up beside him. He kissed her. Nothing fancy. And she kissed him back the same way, lips parted and soft.
Not bad,
she said when he finished. He put his arms around her and kissed her some more. He tried a little tongue and she responded, and he thought, is this finally going to be it? Here in the middle of the parking lot? But when he put a hand on her breast, she gently removed it and said,
easy college boy, no paw prints on the clean shirt.
I could help you get out of it, he said. She turned her mouth down again.
I don't think so. Our acquaintance is not even as old as your boots, and your boots ain't half broke in yet.
He made to kiss her again, and she wriggled free.
I think we better work on those boots some more. Two more dances, then you go home and get them off before your feet swell up to where you have to sleep in them.
Cole ended up with her phone number and a vague promise to see him again the next Saturday.
There's a two-step lesson at 7, she said.
Will you be there?
I don't need lessons,
she said. On the drive to the Tyler Motor Inn, he pressed for information.
How do you guys know her?
Everybody knows Karina, Jerry said.
Did either of you guys ever, you know,
fuck her? Donald said. In my dreams. If Jerry says he's dead, he's lying.
All that beer had left Jerry contented and Donald irritable.
As far as my personal experience goes, Jerry said, she could be all flirt and no follow-through.
He caught Cole's eye in the rearview mirror.
I surely doubt it, though.
The boots were, in fact, a problem. And by the time he got the first one off, he was afraid he might have done permanent damage to his foot in the process. He wrenched the other one off anyway. Then, after relieving the terrible pressure of his desire, he was awake for another hour, calming down. It didn't help that the sound of highly vocal sex was coming through the thin plywood wall. He tried Karina's number throughout the day on Sunday. Between calls, he practiced two-step and guitar and walked in his new boots to the Silver Spoon Cafe, inevitably the greasy spoon to Donald and Jerry, for a late breakfast and then for an early supper. He finally caught her at 8:30. She seemed happy enough to hear from him. They were on the phone for close to an hour, talking about Shakespeare and country music and growing up in Tyler, Texas. Cole mostly listened. At the end, she told him he was sweet and said she would maybe see him on Saturday. Say you'll see me for sure on Saturday so I can go to sleep happy.
Maybe for sure, she said. Good night, college boy.
Drummer number 3 was named Gary Travis, and Alex took a dislike to him at first sight. He was 5'10", skinny, and had his black hair slicked back in a style at least 5 years out of date. He wore khaki pants instead of jeans and a madras shirt with a button-down collar. He was Mike Moss's idea. Mike didn't know much about him beyond the fact that he played with the Richardson High Band. Mike had run into him at Preston Record Center after drummers 1 and 2 had washed out and asked if he played rock. He'd shrugged and said,
"Sure, nothing much to it."
He had the smallest drum set Alex had ever seen, the bass drum not much bigger than the last drummer's floor tom. He'd spread a rug on the floor of Alex's garage before setting up, and he spent more time tuning his heads than he had putting the hardware together, holding his left stick in the crook of his thumb, jazz style. When he was ready, Alex handed him the song list and said, "The ones with the check marks we've worked on at least enough to get through." He'd already explained on their initial phone call about Cole. Gary glanced over the list and said, "Why don't we start with Shake? That'll give you a taste of what I can do." They had already tuned Alex's bass and Mike's guitar to his Vox Continental organ. "Go ahead and count it off," Alex said, thinking this shouldn't take long. "Animals or Sam Cooke?" The Animals version was the only one Alex knew. He looked at Mike, who said,
What's the difference?"
"Animals is faster. The drums are more interesting in the Cooke version." Smartass, Alex thought. "Cooke, then." It took about 5 seconds for Alex to change his mind. Instead of playing through on the hi-hat and snare like the Animals drummer did, Gary played the bass line on his tom-toms. It wasn't fancy, no more than single notes in perfect time. Instead of driving, it swung. On the verses, that jazzy left hand hit with snap and authority. By the end of the song, Alex was wondering what they could offer him to get him to stay. "On the Cooke version," Gary said, "it's just the drums the first time through, bass and drums a second time, add guitar for the third, and on the last one he's got horns. I guess that's where your lead player would come in." Maybe, Alex thought, putting up with Gary's shit was a high enough price to pay. "Let's try it again," he said. Alex called "Look Through Any Window" next because the Hollies had the best drummer in the business and Alex knew what the part should sound like. Gary counted it off and played a credible version, simpler here and there, always with the right feel, solid on the 2 and 4. Mike said,
"I thought you said you'd never played in a rock band before."
"Never have," he said. "I listen to this stuff all day and night, though. This is cool. Can we do another one?" They played for an hour, then went in the house for Cokes. "You're a secret weapon, man," Alex told him. "I would kill to have you in this band. I don't know if we're good enough for you."
"Depends on the lead player, I guess," Gary said.
"You guys can both really sing, and I can't sing for doodly squat." "He can sing too," Alex said. "We can do We Five. We can do Birds, Beatles, everything." Gary looked through the set list and said,
"Okay, you've got Sloopy on here, of course, but have you ever heard the original?"
"Original?" Alex said. "It's a cover of My Girl Sloopy by a colored group called The Vibrations. I brought a few records with me if you want to hear it."
Alex reminded himself how good the guy's drumming was and bit back his irritation.
"Yeah, sure, why not?" In Alex's room, Gary took the lid off a cardboard pattern box from SoHo Fabrics and pulled out a single on the red and black Atlantic label. Alex dropped the needle on it. You could tell it was the same song, though the feel was different in the same way that Gary's version of Shake was different. That swing again, and much more. Conga drums rattled in the foreground and a cheesy organ fought to be heard in the back. Horns came in every now and then to kick everything in the ass. Through it all, a live audience shrieked and laughed and applauded. Alex liked R&B the same as everybody did. Motown, Wilson Pickett, the Isleys, Chuck Berry, they were all on the song list. This was different. Raw, sweaty, loose. It evoked a world of dark, gyrating women, spilled whiskey and flashing razors that was completely alien to Alex's privileged existence, as alluring as it was frightening. "Where did you get this?" he said.
I went to England with my folks last summer, Gary said. The kids over there were crazy for American music. They kept asking me about all these people I'd never heard of. Arthur Alexander, Don Covey, Bobby Blue Bland. They thought I was a moron not to know about this stuff that was right under my nose, so when I got back, I started going to Goodwill and places like that, looking for old records. Here, listen to this. He handed Alex another Atlantic single, Don Covey singing Mercy, Mercy, which the Stones had covered. After that, Doris Troy's Just One Look. Hear that rhythm? Gary said. That backbeat, one and two and. That's some kind of calypso thing out of Jamaica. The Hollies toned it down and sped it up so it doesn't slam you in the gut like this does. Alex was feverish. Suddenly, all of rock music looked like a paint-by-numbers imitation of something primal and vital and authentic, something Alex had no claim to because he was too light-skinned, too suburban, too rich. He felt like a phony for trying to start a band at all. Can I, he said, pointing to the SoHo box. Gary nodded, and Alex slid out one record after another and eased it back, each in its paper sleeve with a hole for the label, each label bearing a name that at best he'd heard mentioned somewhere. I need to, words failed him. I have to. Gary looked at his watch.
I was going to hit a few stores this afternoon. You can come along if you like. I can point you to some stuff.
They both looked at Mike.
I have to get home, Mike said. You guys go ahead.
Yeah, Alex told Gary. I would dig that. As the months slipped by, Dave became increasingly desperate to find the act that would launch his production career. He worried that the boom was over already. Early in the year, Jake had recorded The Charlatans in one of the few decent studios in San Francisco, Coast Recorders on Folsom Street, and failed to get anything worthy of a record contract. They were not impressive as musicians, Jake said, couldn't agree on a sound or a direction, and were tense and wooden in the studio. Meanwhile, trouble was brewing in the Spoonful. John had fallen for a woman who'd been with Zal first, and Zal, who had difficulty with the line between teasing and harassment, would not let him forget it. Dave knew that side of Zal well. Late one night, as the two of them stood on 52nd Street outside the Columbia Studios service elevator, waiting for a cab, Zal had said,
"Your real name's not Dave Fisher, you're one of the tribe."
Dave had told him the story, and Zal had called him Fischl ever since, usually in a mocking falsetto voice. Maybe it was all in good fun, though when it came from Zalman Yanofsky, who had never tried to hide his identity, who had lived on a kibbutz in Israel, for God's sake, it turned into an accusation that twisted Dave with shame, to Zal's never-ending delight. Then, on May 19th, after a gig in Berkeley, Zal and Steve had driven over to Pacific Heights and bought a couple of lids from Bill Love of the committee. Coming back, they'd attracted the attention of the cops with some crazy driving and ended up in jail. Zal, being a Canadian citizen, faced deportation and a permanent ban on re-entering the U.S. Nobody in band circles was talking about it. Dave suspected, without knowing any details, that they'd made some kind of a deal with the cops. He only felt it as one more source of tension when they cut Summer in the City, even as he started to come into his own in the studio, miking a garbage can and sending it through the speakers in the stairwell to get the boom for the opening. Using the stairwell echo on Joe's snare, recording car horns on the street, making his mark on the record. He'd put the word out among the local studio musicians that he was looking for an act to produce, and after a few bum steers, a sax player from Jersey told him about some Bayonne guys called the Meteors, real pros, supposedly. So on a Friday in late July, he took a bus all the way down to Asbury Park to hear them play a place called Mrs. J's Beer Garden. He got there at 8:00, after a cab ride through streets full of kids in beat-up cars. Mrs. J's was a white brick building on a corner lot facing the ocean, dingy with soot, with Harleys and hot rod Fords, Dodge Darts, Volkswagen Beetles parked out front, rough kids in jeans and dirty white t-shirts and tattoos lounging against the walls, smoking and watching him suspiciously. If it hadn't meant another 3-hour bus ride to get home, Dave might have chickened out then and there. He also regretted wearing a suit, which had lost its press on the bus. He'd been afraid people might not take him seriously if he did end up handing out the new business cards he'd brought, the ones with a Columbia logo on them without Columbia's permission. Now he worried that they'd think he was a cop. Hunger decided him. He pushed through the double glass doors into the end of the dinner rush. The interior was a gigantic sweat box where waitresses squeezed through the crowd with trays overhead. Everybody was talking at the top of their lungs, and a blaring jukebox was barely audible in the background. He found an open stool at the bar and ordered the blue plate special: chicken fried steak, mashed potatoes, green beans, roll, and iced tea for 89 cents. By the time he finished, the band was loading in their equipment. At first, Dave took them for older, maybe past their prime. On second glance, they were just tough, working-class Italian kids, probably tired from schlepping their gear all the way from Bayonne. That gear including a full-sized Hammond B3 and Leslie, two matching Vox Super Beetle amps, and the biggest drum set Dave had ever seen. After the setup and a quick sound check, they disappeared for half an hour. Then, at 9:30 exactly, they hit the stage running, now dressed in matching black shirts and white ties, guitars tuned and strapped on, and they plugged in and counted off the first song before the audience had fully registered that they were there. The first song was Shotgun, the Junior Walker hit, and they blasted it out in four-part harmony, with blistering guitar fills and percussive riffs from the B3 that sounded like a helicopter landing on the checkered linoleum floor and felt like a boxer pounding on Dave's solar plexus. No vestige remained of their earlier fatigue as they charged into the next song and a crowd started to form in front of the stage. By the time that second song was over, Dave knew he wanted to sign them, and by the third, he was afraid someone was going to beat him to it. The rest of the first set struck mostly to R&B, soul, and blues standards. Bobby Bland, Smokey Robinson, Little Eva, Bo Diddley. The occasional curveballs included Elvis's Don't Be Cruel and the Rascals' arrangement of Good Lovin'. Everybody except the drummer took turns singing lead, and they switched off between guitar-driven songs and organ-driven songs. They changed up the keys and the tempos and ended with a 10-minute workout on Ray Charles's What Did I Say, going straight into Green Onions for the break. Dave was petrified. All the lines he'd rehearsed deserted him. Only the fear of another scout being in the audience got him onto his feet. In a haze of fear, he followed the band and an entourage of girls into an overlit break room with a noisy refrigerator, a sink, a formica table, and a collection of mismatched chairs. The guys collapsed into the chairs, and one of the girls went to the fridge and passed around bottles of beer. The rest of the girls seemed unsure what to do now that they were here. Dave felt much the same way. The guys had noticed him, however, so he had to say something.
My name is Dave Fisher. I'm from Columbia Records, and I think you guys are great.
They looked at each other, and the sudden wonder, hope, and excitement on their faces boosted Dave's confidence. He grabbed a chair and sat in it backwards.
Have any of the other labels talked to you yet?
They had probably been imagining this moment for years, Dave thought. The drummer was the first to respond, a shake of the head.
Have you got a manager, a booking agent?
The organist spoke up. He'd recovered his wariness, and though he was hollow-cheeked skinny, he had a wiry menace.
To play dumps like this one, we don't need a manager. Bodyguards, maybe, the drummer said, and they all laughed.
How about original material? Do you guys write any of your own songs?
We got a few, the organist said. Maybe five.
6, the guitar player said, sitting up self-consciously like he'd been called on in school. We got paradise, remember?
6, the organist said.
Have you recorded any of them? Demo tapes, singles, anything like that? All but the bass player shook their heads. Can you do me a favor, maybe play some of them tonight?
We'll play them all,
the drummer said, then looked at the organist for confirmation. Sure, the organist said.
Not in a bunch, though. This crowd, they like stuff they know from the radio.
That's the way of it, isn't it? Dave said. The clubs want covers, but you can't make that next step until you do originals. He was talking too much.
Listen, I can't promise anything, but I would maybe like to put together a showcase for you in the city. Get some people from the label down to hear you, see what they think.
Hell yes, the drummer said. Showcase, the organist said. A club gig with some big shots in the audience. You want to pack the house, you know, get lots of girls there who'll scream and dance.
He glanced at the girls who were watching with wide eyes. One of them said, I can scream.
She smiled and licked her lips.
The organist looked at her and said, see me after the show.
How can I get a hold of you? Dave asked.
The organist took a business card out of his wallet. Under the name The Meteors was a drawing of a rock with speed lines, the names Sal, Tim, Rocky, and Mike, and 2 phone numbers.
Who's Sal?
That's me, the organist said. The first number on the card is me. Dave shook his hand, and Sal said, what was your name again?
Blushing and hating it, he said, Dave.
Dave Fisher.
He remembered his own business cards and passed them around, shaking hands with the others. Tim on guitar, Rocky on bass, Mike on drums.
Anybody under 18? Dave asked.
The guys all shook their heads. One of the girls started to raise her hand, and the girl next to her slapped it down and said,
not you, stupid.
Good, good. That'll make it easier if we get to the point of a contract.
Time, he thought, to quit while he was ahead. It was good meeting you guys. I hope to talk to you soon.
You too, said Mike the drummer, and Tim the guitar player chimed in with, thanks.
Sal was reading Dave's card like a cryptogram he was trying to solve.
Rocky remained inscrutable.
Dave let himself out, and as soon as he closed the door, he heard the band let out a cheer. Dave felt like cheering, too. He spent the rest of the night in a daze. He had tunnel vision, and his brain kept flying to the 4 corners of the universe, already trying to picture the album cover, to decide which cover tunes to keep, how he would mic the instruments. 2 of the band's originals sounded like hits, and 2 more were good enough for B-sides or album filler. Enough for a start.
He knew that word of who he was had spread through the club when people began to sneak looks at him. He was 2 parts embarrassed to 1 part pleased with himself. During the 3rd break, a tall, skinny guy with an oversized jaw and forehead of acromegaly sat hunched and uninvited at Dave's table and explained that he was the next Dylan. To get rid of him, Dave traded one of his new business cards for the kid's address scrawled on the back of an envelope. By 1:30, when the band finished, the club had emptied out except for a few old men passed out in the booths and a dozen or so girls. Dave said goodnight as the band was tearing down and promised to be in touch. At the bar, he asked where he might be able to find a room.
No chance, the bartender said. On a Friday on the shore in July, everything's booked up months ahead.
He was dipping beer steins 2 at a time in a sink of gray suds.
Can I get back to Manhattan?
First bus is 6 in the morning. He didn't meet Dave's eyes.
What am I gonna do?
Dave hated the desperation in his voice.
Can't sleep here, the bartender said. Try the bus station.
A female voice behind him said, I can take you as far as Bayonne. He turned to see a blonde in her mid-20s, a bit the worse for wear, dark roots, sympathetic eyes. You can cab into the city from there. Her name was Crystal, and she had a blue and white Chevy Bel Air with a sizable dent in the rear bumper. As they got in, she said,
I imagine you're worn out, so if you want to sleep, that's okay. I'm a nurse, so I'm used to being awake at all hours.
I may never sleep again, Dave said.
She smiled like she meant to collect that verbal IOU later and put the car in gear.
My ex used to tell me that I was to talking what a hurricane was to fresh air, so feel free to interrupt if I get on a streak.
You're very generous to help me out.
Trusting was the word he was thinking, which she seemed to pick up.
Oh, you're safe, I can tell.
I don't know if that's a compliment or not.
Believe me, I had enough of the other with my ex.
Contrary to her ex's warning, they cruised in companionable silence down Asbury Avenue, past the boardwalk and the weathered wood-frame shops and the last of the tourists.
What's your connection with the band?
Dave finally asked as they turned onto the Garden State Parkway.
One of my girlfriends dated Sal for a while.
She gave him a sardonic look.
Dated, yeah, right. Anyway, we followed the band around a little. I love music. I love to dance. And they're the best combo in Jersey, so I kept going after my girlfriend got tired of standing in line for a turn with Sal.
She looked at him again.
I know what you're thinking. You're thinking she's too old for this, among other things.
I'm way older than you are, and here I am.
Yeah, but that's your job, right? I mean, I heard you're a producer for Columbia.
Already Dave liked her enough not to say yes. He explained the leap he was trying to make, which led to telling her stories about the studio and traveling with the Spoonful, whom she loved. She had a raucous laugh that matched her working-class Jersey accent, and Dave did his best to hear it again and again. She pulled up in front of her apartment building a little after 3 a.m. She turned sideways on the seat to face him.
I can call you a cab, or...
Or, he said.
She smiled.
Or...
This is where, he thought, the old Dave would have been overcome by shyness and run away.
Or sounds good, he said.
Dave didn't leave her apartment until Sunday afternoon. It had been a long time for him, for her too. She made breakfast and lunch and ordered in the best delivery pizza Dave had ever eaten, and in between she told him about Bayonne.
The whole town is in a time warp. You can still hear doo-wop groups practicing in the alleys where they can get a good echo. People who were born in Bayonne work in Bayonne and die in Bayonne. My mom is at the Maidenform factory up the street, and my dad was at one of the refineries out on the hook until they moved it down south to get away from the unions.
She told him about boarded-up storefronts and that the closest thing to parkland when she was a kid was vacant lots. Her older brother Tommy hated it and was always going over the bridge to Staten Island, where the drinking age was 18. Until the night 8 years ago, when his best friend's car crashed into the concrete abutment coming off the bridge onto the boulevard. The other kids had gotten away with contusions, and Tommy, riding shotgun, had gone through the windshield. Her parents found a way to blame each other, and Crystal moved out as soon as she finished high school. She played him her well-worn 45s, from the Church Street Five and the Dovells to Mitch Ryder and the Young Rascals. She'd gotten the music bug early, hypnotized by the jukebox at the candy store where the kids all hung out, drinking fountain cokes and working out jitterbug moves. This is the world we're tearing down, Dave thought. Mitch Miller's world. The world of crew cuts and soda fountains and dead-end factory jobs. When he finally got in the cab for Manhattan, he had a tentative promise that she would come into the city the next weekend, and he would take her to the village and the garden and the park, anywhere she wanted to go. On Monday, he called Joe Mara at the Night Owl, who agreed to hire the band on Dave's recommendation and found him a Wednesday night slot 2 weeks away. He called Sal that afternoon to confirm the booking. Sal pushed for details. Who would be there? What would the next steps be? What kind of advance was Dave thinking of? Dave tried in vain to scale down his expectations.
You do like the band, right? Sal said. You do want to record us.
If everything works out, Dave said, we'll see.
On Tuesday, he made an appointment with Columbia's new head of A&R, Morgan Conrad, who had replaced Mitch Miller the year before. Although Dave barely knew him, Conrad was the one who would have to okay his move from engineering to production. Dave got 15 minutes before Conrad was scheduled for a working lunch. He tried not to let himself think about how much was at stake. This was the way of things, after all. Bring the company a great band, get to produce them as your reward. Conrad was running late. Dave lost the first 10 minutes of his appointment, and Conrad looked at his watch as soon as they'd shaken hands. He was tanned and fit, his white hair was cut short, and a display handkerchief stuck out of the pocket of his Italian suit. "I've been hearing good things about your work," Conrad said, "in and out of Colombia." Dave ignored the implied reprimand. "Thank you, sir. I know you're in a hurry, so I'll get to the point. I've found a terrific young rock group and set up a showcase for them 2 weeks from tomorrow. If you think they're as commercial as I do, I'd like the chance to produce them." "Whoa, slow down, Dave. Who gave you permission to scout acts?"
"I was showing initiative, sir. That's always the way it's been here, all of us on the lookout for talent that might bring the company a hit record."
"I appreciate the history lesson, but I'm not automatically persuaded that the way things have always been is the best way to do business. Furthermore, there's no established career track from engineering to A&R. They're two very different professions." Conrad had produced a few stereo demonstration records in the late 50s for Audio Fidelity, then moved into entertainment law. He'd been at Columbia less than a year. To his surprise, Dave's feelings of panic were manifesting as homicidal rage. He struggled to keep his voice even and reasonable. "I apologize if I was out of line. Regardless of how it happened, there's going to be a terrific group called the Meteors playing at the Night Owl on August 10th, and Columbia has the inside track on signing them." "What did you promise this group?"
"Nothing, sir. I told them I liked their sound and that I would like some other people at the company to hear them."
"And did you represent yourself in any way as having the authority to offer them a contract?"
"No, of course not. I just told them that I worked at Columbia."
"And I hope that continues to be the case." At that, Dave's hands clenched the arms of the chair as if he had them around Conrad's throat. "I suggest you cancel this showcase and return to your assigned duties. In time, if your work remains solid, maybe we can let you co-produce one of the existing acts on our roster." Dave was too livid to speak. He got up and started for the door.
"Dave?"
Dave hesitated with his hand on the knob.
"We're not cowboys here," Conrad said.
"Not anymore.
It's a new day."
Dave managed not to slam the door on his way out. Dave spent the afternoon waiting for callbacks from Jake, from Tom Dowd at Atlantic, and from Phil Ramone at A&R Studios. They were the only people in town that he trusted with the Meteors, and all three eventually phoned to say they would be there for the showcase. They all wanted to know why he wasn't signing them to Columbia, and he said, "Columbia has made it clear I don't have that authority." He needed Dutch courage that night before he called Crystal. He hadn't eaten all day, and he wasn't used to drinking in the first place. He needed three tries to dial her number because of the shaking in his hands. She was completely tied up with the Meteors in his mind, and he knew that the longer he waited to call, the harder it would get. As soon as she heard his voice, she said, "What's wrong?" He gave her the blow-by-blow. She was quiet for so long after that he finally said, "Are you there?"
"Why didn't you go to this Tom Dowd guy and say, if you like this band, you have to hire me as a producer?"
"None of these guys are in a position to hire me, except maybe as an engineer."
"So are you going to engineer the record if they produce it?"
That would be like going to watch a woman I was in love with marry somebody else."
"Jesus and Mary, you're not even going to the club to see them, are you?"
"I doubt it."
After another excruciating silence, he said, "I'll talk to you later."
"Dave, wait," she said.
But the blackness of his mood had swallowed him, and he hung up the phone.
A part of him hoped she would call him back, and when she didn't, he turned out the lights and got undressed. He lay on his back and listened to the noise of the street through the open window, the sirens and the horns, and the squealing brakes. The next afternoon, he called Sal.
Can we meet? Dave said. I have a couple of things to discuss with you.
We're playing tonight, Sal said.
His voice was still belligerent, as if that was how he always dealt with Hope.
Can't we do it over the phone?
Yeah, okay, listen, there's a change in the lineup for the showcase.
A change in the lineup? What the fuck does that mean?
Columbia's out, but I've got...
What do you mean Columbia's out?
Columbia doesn't want to send anybody to the show, but I've got...
They don't want to send anybody? What the fuck? Are you a producer there or not?
I never said I was a producer. I said,
you're not a producer? Then what the fuck are you doing handing out your business cards and setting up fucking showcases?
Sal,
what the fuck are you doing playing with us like this?
Sal, shut the fuck up. Shut the fuck up and listen to what I'm saying to you. I've got Tom Dowd, Phil Ramone, and Eric Jacobson coming to see your fucking show, all right? That's the guys that produce fucking Ray Charles and the Rascals, John fucking Coltrane, the Lovin' Spoonful, all right? So you are actually three times better off than you would have been if Columbia came, and I am not going to make a fucking penny out of this if you get a record deal. I did it because I didn't want to let you down, all right? He was shaking again, listening to the silence over a phone line again. Finally, quietly, Sal said,
Tom Dowd? You got Tom Dowd to come hear us?
That's right. Don't fuck it up. Get to your originals right away, and if you want to write a couple more in the next 2 weeks, that might be a real good idea. Bring a lot of people and make sure they yell requests for the originals. Got it?
Dave, I'm sorry, Sal said. We've been through a lot of disappointment, you know?
Yeah, Dave said. Tell me about it. Dave started to dial Crystal's number 20 times over the next 2 weeks. Once, he made it all the way through. He hung up after 10 rings. The day after the showcase, Tom Dowd called him.
I owe you one. I'm cutting a demo with them next week, and if it sounds as good as I think it will, we'll probably release it as a single.
I hope they sell a million, Dave said.
I still don't see what you're getting out of this.
I'm not sure I do either, Dave said. But somebody ought to get what they wanted out of this deal. By the end of July, Cole's patience was gone. His boots were broken in, and he could glide across the dance floor with a reasonable amount of flair. If he only had a hat, Jerry told him, the women would be all over him. The woman he wanted all over him had come back to the Tyler Motor Inn with him three times. He'd gotten her out of her bra, but the minute his hands went below her waist, she pulled away. He'd played guitar and sung for her.
Not bad,
was all she ever said, though he knew she was impressed. They'd spent hours on the phone, Cole searching for hidden meanings in everything she said and everything she didn't. She was not hard to figure. Father split when she was five, mother's attempts at dating hadn't worked out, no female friends. Other girls were either jealous or too provincial. She was too smart and too ambitious for Tyler. Cole was just a kid, as she never tired of reminding him, and she was looking for a lifeline to the big city, whatever big city was available. As for work, the sum total he'd gained from his days on the rig was some muscle on his upper body and a farmer's tan. He couldn't imagine what it would be like to have that for his future, with nothing more to look forward to than a wife and kids, spending his pay as fast as he earned it. His alarm went off at 6 a.m. on Monday, August 1st. He felt dazed, irritable, clumsy. The first day of his next to last week, and he didn't know how he was going to endure the next 12 days. Corina had been over the night before, and he'd played Do You Believe in Magic? And the contours, Do You Love Me, because of the line about, Now That I Can Dance. He'd finished with Ray Peterson's Corrine Corina, which he'd worked up especially for her. The usual mixture of making out and wrestling ensued. Karina never got carried away with the heat of it the way Cole did. He'd asked her about it, and she'd said she liked the closeness, that he was sweet. But what she may or may not have felt in the realm of passion was not something she intended to share with a kid like him. He hadn't gotten to sleep until nearly one. He was sitting in his open doorway when Donald and Jerry pulled up at 6:25. Donald was already dipping his wintergreen Copenhagen, and the inside of the Falcon smelled like mint and rotting leaves. Cole's stomach wanted to turn inside out. Jerry looked him over in the rear view.
Looking a mite green this morning, College. Karina kept you up last night?
Not the way I wanted her to, Cole said.
You should talk to your daddy, Donald said and spat into a paper cup. Maybe he could pull some strings.
I think all this frustration is beginning to interfere with your job performance.
They both liked to kid him about his father having gotten him the job. Cole knew that if they had a real problem with it, the talk would have been behind his back. At the greasy spoon, he was unable to finish his eggs or start his bacon, and Donald obligingly took care of both.
If your daddy could see you now, Donald said, hangover and blue balls. Not the summer he had in mind for you, I imagine.
At the rig, they found that the graveyard tower, which Cole had learned, in keeping with tradition, to rhyme with hour, had started tripping pipe at dawn. Every joint of pipe had to come out of the hole, be unscrewed from the string, and dropped in the rack, all 6,000 feet of it at this point, to get to the drill bit to replace it. Time spent tripping was money for no new footage, creating pressure to get it done as quickly as possible. They changed clothes in the doghouse, each turning his back to the others in the quaint modesty of rural men that Cole studiously followed. He hated the first clammy touch of the sweaty, oil-stained jeans and t-shirt from the previous day. They put on their hard hats and went out onto the steel floor of the derrick, which stank of diesel and lubricating mud and vibrated constantly from the 1,500-horsepower motor. Elton, the driller on the daylight tower, was in his 40s, his face as cracked and brown as drought-ravaged farmland. Stray salt-and-pepper whiskers where he'd missed shaving. Each of the three drillers was the lead man on his shift, and all three reported to the tool pusher, the boss of the rig. Though Elton was generally easygoing, every time they started a trip, he ordered Cole off the rig, said he could get a closer look another time. Today, as Jerry scampered up to the monkey board, 85 feet above the derrick floor, and the rest of the crew swarmed in to replace their graveyard tower counterparts, Elton finally said,
"You can stay on the floor, but keep at least 5 feet away from the rotary, and don't get in nobody's way. Watch what they're doing, and watch out for the fucking chain."
Elton went to the graveyard driller and took his place behind the big lever that controlled the throttle. Two roughnecks from the graveyard tower stood over the rotary while Elton hoisted a thribble, three connected joints of pipe, out of the hole. One of the roughnecks slapped a collar around the top of the fourth joint to hold it in place, while the other swung a 4-foot pipe wrench onto the bottom of the thribble and gave it a full turn counterclockwise. As soon as he pulled the wrench off, the first roughneck whipped one end of a heavy chain around the same spot, whistled at Elton, and then stepped away while the motor pulled the chain hard enough to spin the thribble free. The chain was barely off when Elton hoisted the pipe into the air, and the graveyard derrickman, high up in the lattice of the rig, wrapped his own chain around the top of it and pulled it toward the rack at the side of the derrick where another 24 thribbles already stood, the roughnecks on the floor putting their shoulders into it to push from below. Seeing the process up close was infinitely more alarming than watching it from a distance. The roughnecks joked and pulled faces at the same time that each of their movements had a fierce concentration and precision. Things happened so fast that there was no leeway in the system, no room to take a breath. Even as he thought that, some small, anomalous sound or shadow made him look up and see the body falling toward him and a glint of metal in the air. He reflexively lifted his right hand. Something brushed his glove and knocked his hand away, hard, before clanging into the metal floor, and then somebody yanked him backward, off his feet, and he heard, but didn't see, Jerry's body slam into the derrick floor a couple of feet away. Cole tried to stand up. His legs refused to take his weight. He ended up on one knee, a noise like amplifier hum in his ears. Jerry lay on his neck, twisted all wrong and blood leaking out of his hard hat. The life was gone from his face, like it was a rubber mask. Elton knelt next to him, hand to Jerry's throat. Feeling for a pulse, Cole thought, though there was clearly no point.
Get that pipe in the rack, Elton yelled, before somebody else gets hurt.
Donald was standing over Jerry's body now, saying,
Oh, Jesus, oh, Jesus.
Call an ambulance, Elton told him. The number's on the phone.
Donald didn't hear. When Cole tried to get up and do it himself, everything tilted, and he had to catch himself with his right hand, which was weirdly numb. The graveyard derrickman was yelling as he came flying down the ladder.
What happened? I didn't even see him fall. Is he?
The pipe banged into the rack, and then both shifts gathered awkwardly around the body, some of the men pulling off their hard hats. A couple of them, including the graveyard derrickman, looked like they were about to cry.
He came up onto the monkey board, the derrickman said, giving me shit like he always done. I had my back to him. I was working on a string. I never seen him. Just out of the corner of my eye when he was already falling.
Will somebody call a fucking ambulance? Elton said.
Two of the men ran for the doghouse. Cole was thirsty, and he needed to lie down. His head felt fizzy. He didn't want to say anything because Jerry was dead, and whatever was wrong with him was probably just him being a wimp, and he didn't want the others to notice him in this condition. He sat down heavily. Somebody said,
Something's the matter with Cole.
Look at his hand. He's bleeding.
Cole understood that they were talking about him. He didn't have the strength to respond. Somebody had him by the shoulders.
Lean over, he said. Lean your head between your legs. Hey, somebody get some water.
Cole leaned forward and felt the blood rush into his brain. Somebody had a red plaid thermos of iced tea. He tried to reach for it with his right hand, and a voice said,
Left hand, use your left.
Somebody else said,
Get the glove off him. Gentle now.
He took a drink with his left hand. Somebody knelt next to him and gripped his right arm tightly. Somebody else started pulling his glove and it stung his middle finger.
Oh, shit,
somebody said.
Is that ambulance coming?
Said somebody else. Cole looked at his hand. The end of his finger was a bloody ruin, blood dribbling out onto the derrick floor. His peripheral vision went dark.
Take it easy, man, somebody said, patting him on the shoulder.
There was something important he had to do.
Jerry, he said, just take her easy.
He heard a siren in the distance. There's an ambulance now, he thought. Maybe somebody could flag it down. Elton helped him to his feet, putting Cole's left arm around his neck.
Lean on me, Elton said. I got you.
Cole was able to make his legs move. His heavy work boots dragged against the textured steel floor.
That's it, Elton said. Watch the stairs.
I'm never gonna live this down, Cole thought, as Elton helped him stumble down the steps to ground level, having to be carried off the rig like a baby. He felt something in the palm and wrist of his right hand. Not pain yet, but an IOU for pain, and the numbers on it were high. The ambulance backed up to within 50 feet of the rig. It looked like a station wagon his parents used to have, only the body was bright red, and the top of the back part was solid white and studded with lights. Two young guys in white coveralls came running, carrying a stretcher that looked like an oversized ironing board.
Take this one first, Elton said. It's too late for the other one.
They laid Cole out on the stretcher and strapped him down, then carried him to the ambulance, setting him on the ground by the open back door. One of them wrapped Cole's hand in gauze while the other gave him a shot in his left arm. The one who'd wrapped his hand knelt down. He had red hair and freckles and was only a few years older than Cole.
If you feel weird, it's because you're in shock, okay?
It's something your body does to keep you from feeling what happened to you. I want you to keep your right hand pointing up at the sky like they're swearing you in on Perry Mason. You're going to be okay. We got to go get the other guy and we'll be right back. As they grabbed another stretcher and sprinted away, the shot began to take effect. Cole had never felt anything like it. The stretcher turned into a giant rubber raft and floated away into the ocean, bobbing gently to the rhythm of his pulse. A cool breeze touched his cheek and time stopped. Cole watched the clouds overhead. The sky was the exact blue of a colored pencil that he'd had in fifth grade. They came back with Jerry on the other stretcher. A sheet stained reddish-brown was pulled up over his face. They slotted Jerry's stretcher into the right side of the ambulance, then they lifted Cole. "You can put that arm down now," the redhead said. As they slid Cole in next to Jerry, he was vaguely aware that he would have been claustrophobic if not for the drug. He didn't want to think about Jerry lying so close by. He turned his head the other way and stared out through the window. The ambulance started up and swayed heavily over the rutted road, pines and scrub brush finally giving way to farmland. They emerged onto blacktop and the driver hit the gas. The scream of the siren was comforting in its seriousness. At the hospital, they transferred him to a gurney and left him in a hallway. He'd meant to thank them, and now they were gone. A stark, office-style clock on the wall said that it was not yet 8:45. A young guy in a short white coat took the gauze off and looked at Cole's finger. He had closely trimmed brown hair and a long nose and lots of lines at the ends of his mouth. A plastic tag on his coat said, "Jekyll." "Does it hurt?" he asked. Cole had gotten a peek that didn't bode well. "Starting to," he said. The guy waved a nurse over. "Get me a cc and a half of Demerol, would you?" He looked at Cole again. "Once we get some drugs in you, I'm going to debride this. That means clean it up. They've got a call out for an orthopod to sew this back together, but he's usually out drinking this time of day, and they may have to sober him up." He squinted at Cole. "That's a joke, son." Cole nodded. The nurse came with a hypo and a cotton ball that dripped alcohol. Cole had always hated getting shots before. He couldn't remember why. The guy in the white coat dragged a cart over and turned his back on Cole, tucking the hand under his arm so Cole couldn't see what he was doing. "Are you a doctor?" Cole asked. "Intern," he said. "Almost a doctor, as Bill Cosby says. My name's Pete. What's yours?" "Cole." "Pleased to meet you. Forgive me if I don't shake hands. Nyuk, nyuk, nyuk. How old are you?"
16.
"Well, my boy, I think you are definitely going to get laid out of this deal. The girls will melt with sympathy at the sight of your disfigurement. A touch of the melodrama, let them see how you're suffering inside, you'll be in like Flynn. Can you feel anything when I do this?" Cole had a moment of panic. "No." "That's good, because I'm not doing anything yet." Somebody else, Cole thought, might have been amused. He couldn't stop thinking about the accident. Jerry must have dropped his chain before he fell, and that was what had hit Cole's hand. Why in God's name had he reached up like that? Then the second shot caught up with him and he drifted away. The next time he looked up, he saw that Pete was gone and that the clock now showed a few minutes past 10. The time after that, the gurney was moving and doors flew open in front of him.
"What's happening?" he said.
"We're taking you to surgery," said a female voice.
He was groggy enough, and her East Texas accent was thick enough that he had to puzzle over the words. They brought him to a room that was gray tile and shining steel, and they shifted him onto another, colder surface. His teeth chattered as they strapped him down. 3 nurses, 2 men in white surgical gowns. One of the men put a heavy rubber mask over Cole's nose and mouth.
"Wait," Cole said.
Nobody was listening. The air inside the mask was cold and tasted like metal.
"Take some deep breaths for me," a male voice said.
Cole tried. It tasted bad, and he was shaking with cold.
"I want you to count backwards, starting from 100.
"What are you going to do?" Cole said.
Everything was moving too fast. What if they made a mistake? What if they amputated the entire finger? Another male voice said, "Just be quiet and do what the man says. The sooner you stop arguing, the sooner we can get this over with." The surgeon. The drunk, according to Pete. The kind of bullying authority figure that left Cole intimidated and resentful. 100, Cole said bitterly. 99. He got into the lower 80s before he lost his concentration. Instead of drifting off to sleep, he found himself strapped to the side of a giant metal spiral hundreds of feet long. It turned slowly as it moved through the absolute cold of interstellar space. He saw himself as if from a great distance. His entire body was frozen, and he was terrified and alone. He tried to scream, and nothing came out. The nightmare went on endlessly, the turning spiral, the deadly cold, the fear. It seemed like hours before he floated free and rose upward into warmth. The warmer he got, the more nauseated he felt, and by the time he got his eyes open, his stomach was heaving. "Help," he said. "Throw up." A nurse from a chair beside the bed handed him a beige plastic basin and said, "Take it with your left hand. No, the left. Now try to turn on your side." She was merely heavy above the waist, while her hips and thighs were gigantic. It cost her an effort to stand. She took Cole's right shoulder and gently pulled him toward her. The top half of the bed was cranked high, making it awkward. His stomach convulsed, and he vomited into the basin, got a breath, and vomited some more, all viscous, sour liquid. The nurse wiped his mouth with a wet washcloth and put a sliver of ice into his mouth.
"Suck on it, hon," she said. "It'll help."
She emptied the basin in the toilet and then took his pulse and blood pressure. Her name tag, Cole noted, said Jackie.
"Better now?" she asked.
Cole nodded, then shook his head and pointed at the basin again. Though he heaved repeatedly, only a trickle came up. His right hand burned, and his head spun and ached at the same time. Jackie had him rinse his mouth and spit it out, then emptied the basin again. He lay back, the sweat cooling on his forehead. As long as he stayed completely still, the pain and the nausea were bearable. Then it hit him. His hand, his right hand, his picking hand, smashed. How was he going to play guitar? He held his right hand in front of his face, plaster from palm to elbow, ace bandage and metal brace above that. The ends of his index and ring fingers purple with bruises and orange from disinfectant. Between them, a heavily bandaged stump. The first joint of his middle finger was gone. At the end of what was left was a button on the outside and, sticking out of the bandages on the inside, a long pair of wires as thin as high E strings. The wires appeared to go all the way through the remains of his finger. The thought of it made him dizzy and made the pain in his hand flare as if he'd held a match to it.
"You need something for the pain, hon?"
"Please." She rang the nurse's station for more Demerol. "I can't move my fingers," he said.
"You ain't supposed to move them yet, so don't be trying.
I have to know how bad it is.
Doctors will discuss all that with you when he makes his rounds."
Her tone was not unkind. As soon as he started to relax, another thought hit him. "My parents, somebody needs to tell my parents.
They've been notified. They're on their way. Now settle down and put your hand on those pillows. Fingers up, elbow down."
An orderly came in with the needle, and Jackie gave it to Cole in his hip. He felt it almost immediately, a warmth that spread into his gut and chest and out to the ends of his arms. 2 in the afternoon. The other bed was empty, and the big tinted window next to Cole's bed looked out onto a parking lot and a pine forest beyond. A black and white TV hung from the ceiling, and a bulletin came on, something about a sniper in the tower at the University of Texas. Cole watched grainy footage of the tower as a voice said that at least 10 people were dead, dozens more wounded. They thought the police had killed the sniper. The Demerol made it all unreal. He couldn't make an emotional connection to the fact that Susan was at UT. The idea was incomprehensible, in the same way that Kennedy's assassination had been. It was not something that could have happened in the world he'd known as a child, and it felt like a premonition. He couldn't hold the thought. He turned away, and within a few minutes he began to drift in and out of a light doze, watching the wind move the tops of the pine trees outside his window.
Jeff?
His mother's voice. He rolled onto his back. She had a bouquet of carnations and snapdragons in one hand and an old brown suitcase in the other. The reds and pinks and purples of the flowers clashed in a vaguely unpleasant way with the floral print of her dress.
They said it wasn't too serious, but then they said you lost part of a finger.
Not my fault, he started to say, before he remembered that he didn't have to justify or excuse himself this time. Is Dad here?
He went to the company office. He's going to find out what happened and who's responsible. Don't worry.
I'm not worried, Mother. It was an accident. It wasn't anybody's fault. After a second, he said, A man died out there this morning. One of my friends. I could have been killed too, he wanted to say, if some stranger hadn't yanked me out of the way.
You saw it?
It happened right in front of me.
Well, I...
She was clearly confounded.
I guess these things happen on oil rigs, don't they? That's why they're so dangerous.
Cole saw that she only wanted the unpleasantness to stop. If she let herself feel too much empathy, it would only become more real. How wonderful to have all that Demerol inside him and to not be emotionally involved with this conversation. To not be angry with his mother or devastated by Jerry's death. To not be worried about his hand or disappointed that his father had to be somewhere else.
I brought you your pajamas and toothbrush and some books that were by your bed in case you wanted to read.
That's good, Mom, thanks.
Did you talk to the doctor?
He hasn't come by yet.
The nurse I talked to said he'd already left.
Figures, Cole said.
What, dear?
Nothing. She put the flowers on the tray table and the suitcase on the floor and perched uncomfortably on the edge of the bed.
They certainly did a professional-looking job.
Cole hated to admit that a knot of anxiety in his chest had let go when his mother arrived. He sent her to the nurse's station to find him something to eat. She came back with 2 cups of orange sherbet, turned up the sound on the TV, and settled into a lounge chair to watch. Cole had to let the sherbet soften before he could manage it left-handed. Afterward, his mother left the room while a new nurse helped him use the urinal, a humiliating and not entirely satisfactory experience that felt like wetting the bed. Those efforts wore him out, and he slept until 5 o'clock, when his father arrived, right behind the nurse with Cole's dinner. He wore a white, short-sleeved shirt, wilted from the heat, and a narrow tie. The first thing he said was, I talked to the company. They've agreed to cover all your hospital expenses. And if they hadn't, Cole wondered, were you planning to hand me the bill? The nurse, one he hadn't seen before, put a plastic tray on his rolling table. She was in her 20s, with brown hair and freckles. As she fussed with raising the angle of the bed and getting the table in position, his father said, It doesn't look like there was negligence on the part of the company, though I've arranged to get a copy of the police report. We'll know more then. The nurse took a metal cover off the tray. Roast beef, gravy, mashed potatoes, green beans. Red jello for dessert.
I'll just cut this meat up for you, she said.
Cole thanked her and said, There wasn't any negligence. It was an accident is all. When the nurse finished, Cole's father took her place and said, Let me see your hand. Cole held it out and speared a piece of meat with his left. It took 2 tries. This doesn't look so bad, his father said.
The end of my finger is gone, Cole said. The nurse said, If you need anything, just ring.
Thank you, Cole said. Compared to what could have happened, his father said, you could have lost the entire hand or a foot. That chain could have killed you.
It also, Cole said, could have missed me entirely.
He saw it falling, sparkling in the sunlight, saw his hand reach out. Sweat broke on his forehead.
You won't get far with an attitude like that, his father said.
Now you too,
his mother said.
His father took a step back.
Are they treating you okay? The surgeon, does he seem like he knows what he's doing?
Safe in his Demerol haze, Cole saw that he was on his own. That he always had been. He stood on top of a mountain. The air was cold and clear. He could see a long way. It's fine, Cole said. He'd lost his appetite, but he understood the need for show. He ate a couple of green beans and a bite of potato. The beans were overcooked and tasted of the can they came from.
Good. I hope it's okay, because the company's insurance will only cover this if you stay here in Tyler until they discharge you. Now, if there's a problem with the hospital, we'll pull you out and take you to Dallas.
No, Cole said. No need.
His mother, Cole saw, had not heard this part of it. She looked hurt and confused.
Are we staying?
I have to be at work tomorrow, his father said. You can stay if you want, I suppose. You won't have a car, or a place to stay, or a change of clothes.
She looked helplessly at Cole.
Don't worry, Mom. I'll be fine. It's not that big a deal, right? Like Dad said.
He thought he'd kept the bitterness out of his voice. He shoved another piece of meat in his mouth. The gravy was quickly losing its heat to the hospital air conditioning.
In fact, he said, you've got an hour and a half drive back and you'll need to get something to eat before you go. You should probably get started.
Are you sure?
His mother said.
Are you sure you don't need anything?
You can call me in the morning and check on me. Now, let me finish my dinner in peace before it gets cold. His mother kissed him on the cheek, and his father nodded stiffly.
I mean it about moving you to Dallas, he said.
Try Gringo's Steakhouse, Cole said. They can give you directions at the desk. I eat there. I ate there all the time, with Donald and Jerry.
He managed a smile. As soon as they left, Cole pushed the tray table away and curled onto his side and pushed the call button.
Nurse's station.
Can I get some Demerol in here?
Seconal kept him in a restless sleep all night. And in the morning, an orderly walked him to the bathroom and back. He was shocked at how unsteady he was. After breakfast, he talked to his mother on the phone, and then Pete the intern came by. Today his badge read, Caligari.
Did Granberry ever come by yesterday?
Is that the surgeon? Cole asked.
Alleged surgeon, yes.
No.
Bastard.
Cole didn't know you could talk about surgeons that way.
Is he really a drunk?
No, Pete said. Just an asshole.
Pete unwound the ace bandage. When he saw Cole wince, he ordered more Demerol.
Jackie arrived with the needle, out of breath, and asked which cheek he wanted it in.
The last one was in the right, he said.
How long ago?
I don't remember,
Cole lied.
It's been a while.
Almost 2 hours was a while, if you looked at it right. The warmth hit him as soon as the needle went in. Pavlovian reaction, he knew, a preview of the real thing to follow. Pete touched the tip of Cole's right index finger with the cold metal bell of his stethoscope.
Can you feel that?
Yeah.
Now?
His ring finger.
Yeah.
He didn't do too bad a job for once, Pete said.
You got lucky.
Listen, I play guitar.
Right-handed, with a flat pick?
Cole nodded.
You should be all right.
There's a little hematoma on the fingers on either side.
That's bruises to you,
but they'll heal pretty quick.
You should give yourself 4 weeks.
You won't, but that's what you should do.
Is that button what I think it is?
The wire is holding your tendon in place.
Pete gently wrapped the ace bandage around his fingers.
And yeah, the button is holding the wire that holds the tendon that came from the house that Jack built. That's why you're not supposed to move your fingers yet. If that tendon pops loose, you'll need transplant surgery, and you don't want that. You especially don't want Granberry to do it. The Demerol had been another double dose. Cole was sinking fast.
You got one of those name tags says Moreau?
As a matter of fact.
Monty, your game, Cole said.
Too late, Mr. Holmes. That shot was drugged. I've eluded you again.
Granberry came at 1:20. Pete trailed him, carrying a clipboard. Cole was still flying. Granberry was probably 40, wire-rimmed glasses, long brown hair slicked back from his forehead. He took a cursory look at Cole's hand and said to Pete,
I want him up and moving around this afternoon. Between the drugs and the inactivity, his bowels will lock up. Get him milk of magnesia at bedtime, too.
Yes, sir.
Cole said,
how long do you think I'll need to stay here?
Granberry looked at him as if he'd disobeyed a direct order by speaking.
Until I decide you're healed enough to leave.
Can you give me an estimate?
I'll let you know when you're ready.
Behind Granberry's back, Pete stuck the clipboard crisply under his left arm and stuck the right one out in a Nazi salute, left middle finger under his nose like a mustache. By the time Granberry turned back, Pete was writing on the clipboard as if nothing had happened.
Keep the antibiotics up for at least another day or two, Granberry said. That hand was filthy. Oil and dirt and God knows what all else.
Yes, sir.
Pete followed Granberry out without another word. Drugs gave Cole a heightened appreciation of daytime television. He flipped idly between Let's Make a Deal and As the World Turns, and an hour and a half of Ben Casey reruns. Pete showed up at 3, wearing a name tag that said Hackenbush and towing an aluminum walker. They walked the halls, wheels squeaking on the pale, worn linoleum, Cole resting his cast on top of his head to keep the hand from swelling. Cole told him about the Chevelles and the drummer that Alex had described over the phone. Within 10 minutes, he was sweating, and after 20, he was exhausted and losing his high. The nurse with the freckles gave him a sponge bath and a clean surgical gown and sheets. He'd barely gotten settled when Elton and Donald came in. They'd knocked off early for the occasion, and they were still dirty from the rig. It was awkward from the start. Cole told them the injury wasn't all that bad, and they all nodded. Elton said Jerry's funeral was the next day, Wednesday, and all three towers were getting the day off, with pay, if they went. Donald said,
I reckon it ain't really gonna hit me till the weekend, till I'm sitting at that there wagon wheel all by my lonesome.
Cole saw that, despite his bloodshot eyes, Donald had been raised not to cry, not as long as he was sober anyway. They were glancing toward the door. Cole said, when Jerry fell, somebody grabbed me and pulled me back. I could have died too.
Weren't me, Donald said.
Elton shook his head.
Somebody from the graveyard tower, I think. I didn't see it.
After a silence, he said,
you'll be headed on back to Dallas, I guess, when they let you out.
Yeah, I'm not supposed to use this thing for 4 weeks. We'll try and get by again, Donald said. But if we don't...
I understand. You guys were really good to me.
Now Cole was choked up, and over a job he'd hated.
I appreciate all you did, both you guys, and Jerry, too.
No, Donald said, that ain't what I meant. Whoever it was yanked you out of the way, they gave you a second chance, you know? Don't fuck it up. That's what I was gonna say.
He nodded to Elton, and they started toward the door.
And get a hat, Donald said. Jerry always wanted you to get a hat.
7 p.m., and Cole was still floating, thinking ahead to his next shot. The TV and the overhead lights were off, and the daylight was fading. Cole heard the door open and close.
Hello? He said.
No answer, just footsteps on the other side of the curtain that divided the room. He came fully alert.
Turn the light off, a voice said.
Karina?
Cole put his book on the nightstand and turned off his reading light. Karina went to the window and closed the blinds, leaving the room in deep twilight. She held her finger to her lips and walked slowly to the edge of the bed, one foot directly in front of the other, making her hips sway. She was wearing a dark t-shirt and a light denim skirt and sandals. The cold hospital air made it clear she had nothing on under the shirt. She picked up his cast and studied it.
"Oh, my poor baby," she said.
She kicked off her sandals and climbed carefully onto the bed, straddling him. Like the sniper in the tower, Karina seemed not quite real. When she kissed him, though, gently and repeatedly, and he felt himself getting hard, the drug let him relax with it, let him lie back and follow her lead.
"Your friend Pete?" Karina whispered. "He's watching the door."
She pulled the t-shirt up over her breasts without taking it off. Then, as Cole watched in amazement, she slowly pulled her skirt up around her waist and revealed that she was naked underneath. She dragged the sheet down around Cole's knees and lifted his surgical gown.
"Oh my," she said, "what have we here?"
She controlled everything, and Cole saw that she needed it that way. The weight of the cast bothered him, as did the need to hold it still, as did the angle of the back of the bed and the fear that they might be interrupted. She shushed him when he tried to speak, put his left hand to her breast, kissed him on the neck and chest and stomach, and chose the moment when she finally guided him inside her. She waited for him to fully experience the heat and velvet smoothness of it before she began to move against him, only a little, before pausing to let him savor it again. She did what she could to make it last, but Cole had been waiting too long, and despite all the distractions, the urgency took him and he thrust his hips faster and faster until he exploded endlessly inside her. They slowly rocked to a stop. Cole became aware of the noise of the bed springs, wondered if it had been audible all the way out to the hall. His entire body had been so tense at the end that now his right hand throbbed. His ejaculation ran down between his legs and onto the sheets. Karina kissed him and said,
"Did I hurt you?"
"You've got to be kidding."
"I meant your hand, dummy."
"No," he said. She lifted herself away and plucked a couple of tissues from the nightstand, dabbing at herself and then at the sheets.
"Your nurse is going to be suspicious."
All the while they were making love, he'd been able to believe that they were feeling the same thing. Now they were two separate creatures again, and already he was losing her. She pulled her t-shirt down, and then her skirt. "Wait," Cole said. He wanted her again, wanted to take it slower, with more kissing and touching, wanted her to come too. "Don't go." She climbed out of the bed and put her sandals on.
"Got to, sugar."
She straightened his gown and pulled the sheet and blanket over him.
"There."
"Karina."
"Hush now," she said.
She stood at the head of the bed and stroked his hair. In the near darkness, he couldn't tell whether she was about to cry or was just being theatrical.
"Dream about me tonight,"
she said. She put her fingers to his lips and she was gone. Eventually, Cole pulled the sheet up over his face so that he could smell her on himself and in the bed. He curled on his side, remembering the feel of her body, and drifted until the freckled nurse brought his sleeping pill and milk of magnesia and a shot. Cole dialed Karina's number a dozen times throughout the day on Wednesday and got no answer. Thursday was the same. It wasn't just that he missed her and wanted her again and was sick with love for her. He had no idea what was in her head, whether she loved him too, what their future was going to be. He couldn't think about anything else. He replayed his memories of Tuesday night until they lost their sharpness, until they felt like they belonged to somebody else. Even with Demerol, Cole's daily routines made him restless and left him too much time to brood. Morning phone calls with his mother, walking the halls with Pete twice a day, terse visits from Granberry, tasteless meals, bad TV. On Friday, Granberry said, "I've left orders for you to be discharged on Sunday." Cole's relief was undermined by the knowledge that, Leaving the hospital meant going back to Dallas, an hour and a half from Karina, even if he had a car, every phone call racking up long-distance charges. And in 4 weeks, school would start. He pictured himself housebound until then, his mother fussing over him, and he had an overwhelming desire to hold his guitar. To make the chords and finger the leads with his left hand, even though he couldn't use his right. He rang the nurse's station and asked for a shot. The nurse put Pete on the intercom.
Listen, bud, you've been taking a lot of that stuff. The pain should be starting to ease up. Do me a favor and just put some ice on it for now. If you still need the shot, in an hour you can have it.
Cole looked at the clock. 2:13. Jackie brought a sandwich bag of ice and wrapped it in place with another ace bandage.
It's hard being in here more'n a day or two, I know, she said, patting his shoulder.
The sympathy made Cole's throat close and his eyes sting.
Thank you, he said.
After she left, he dialed Karina's number one more time. On the fourth ring, as he was about to give up, he heard a click on the other end.
Hello? Cole said. Karina? This is her mother.
Who is this?
It's Cole, Jeff Cole. We've never met.
Oh, hello, Cole. How's that hand doing?
At least he thought Karina had talked about him. Coming along. It's going to take a while.
You don't want to rush it now?
No, ma'am.
After a pause, he said, Listen, is Karina? I'm so sorry, Cole. She's gone.
Gone?
Her VISTA application got accepted and she's gone to Philadelphia for training.
She left yesterday morning, said I shouldn't answer the phone, that she was going to write you, but every time it rang, I thought of you in that hospital and I just had to let you know.
Philadelphia? After training, they're going to assign her to some ghetto up there. Oh, Cole, I'm so scared for her, but she was always headstrong. Couldn't nobody talk her out of anything.
How long has she known?
2 weeks.
I asked her, did she tell you about it? She said she would take care of it. She was never good with telling people things they didn't want to hear. Never wanted to disappoint anybody. That was Karina.
Cole noted the ominous past tense. Do you have a phone number for her or an address or anything?
I can tell her you called. That's all I can do.
He tried for 5 minutes to break her down. It was as hopeless as trying to change Karina's mind. He gave her his parents' phone number and the number at the hospital and hung up. He couldn't stop picturing her on a grimy street corner in her cowboy hat and cutoffs, surrounded by tall, dark, leering strangers. 2:41. He focused on the second hand as it clicked slowly around the dial and waited for 3:13. Alex called the Tyler Motor Inn at noon on Saturday, their usual time. He called again at 2 and again at 4. It was possible that Cole wasn't answering because he'd gotten lucky with Karina on his last weekend in the Piney Woods. Alex would not have bet money on it. He called Cole's parents. Cole's father answered, and he handed the phone off to Cole's mother as soon as Alex identified himself. By the time he got the whole story from her, Alex had to fight to control how pissed off he was.
Why didn't you call me? Why didn't you let me know? I would have gone up there.
I'm sorry. I guess I wasn't thinking.
If it had been Alex in the hospital, his parents would have turned the place into Party Central to cheer him up. Cole's parents hadn't even been to see him since the day of the accident.
You say he's coming home tomorrow?
Alex said.
Why don't you let me bring him back?
She was reluctant, and he patiently demolished all her arguments until she agreed to talk to Cole's father and call Alex back. While he waited for the call, Alex talked to his own father, who of course thought it was a great idea. A few minutes later, Betty Cole called and admitted that Cole would probably be happier coming home with Alex. He threw a change of clothes into an overnight bag and his mother put some leftover pot roast and fixings in an ice chest.
You give him our love now, she said.
Alex made it to the hospital before 7 and found his own way to the room. Cole was working the TV remote control, which made a noise like dropping a loaded garbage can onto concrete every time he changed the channel. He had a dazed look, which lit up when he saw Alex. Hey, Cole. I just found out this afternoon. Your fucking parents never told me, man. Something passed across Cole's face that Alex hadn't seen there before. A look a convict might get at the mention of lawyers. Alex kept going. My mom sent food, and I talked to your parents into letting me drive you home tomorrow.
Shit, man, that's great. I am so glad to see you.
Cole blinked and leaned forward.
What the hell happened to you?
Growth spurt, Alex said. I've grown 4 inches since May. I've had to buy all new clothes twice.
Holy shit.
Yeah, my bones hurt, and I can't get enough to eat. At least I don't need my stump cushion to see over the steering wheel anymore.
He shook his head.
Fuck that. Let me see your hand. You couldn't see much. The most disturbing thing was the absence. It was a hand like any other hand, only less so.
Well, Alex said, that's not going to keep you from playing. Good.
Cole didn't say anything. Alex broke out the food and Cole got one of the nurses to bring plates and silverware and a couple of Cokes.
So, Cole finally asked, how's the band?
Alex was braced for the question.
It's shaping up. We had practice number 5 last week. This drummer is amazing. Wait till you hear him.
Cole nodded. You could see how the accident had changed him. His cockiness had been hollowed out.
Listen, man, Alex said. We'll wait as long as we have to until you can play. Don't worry, all right?
The truth was that Mike had been pushing to bring in another guitar player, just temporarily. And Gary had said more than once, this guy must be great if we're waiting all summer for him.
Alex hadn't heard Cole play in 2 months, so he didn't know how good Cole was now, or how he would sound with a full band behind him, or how he would handle himself in front of an audience, and that was before he fucked up his hand.
Alex was gambling everything on friendship and a hunch. The Chevelles had the makings of a seriously commercial act, a much bigger deal than he'd first imagined on the night of the Dylan concert. They only had this 1 year before they all graduated. Mike was shooting for one of the West Coast schools like Reed or Berkeley, and Gary had his eyes on Juilliard, so they'd be scattered across the country. If Cole couldn't cut it, and cut it fast, Alex would have a tough call to make. At the same time, he couldn't deny how empty the summer had seemed without Cole around. He'd had friends from school over to use the pool. He'd met a girl at a party and taken her to the Gemini to see the Wild Angels, where he'd gotten to second base in the back seat. He'd scored some vodka from the older brother of a guy from the tennis team and gotten loaded. None of it had felt like what he really wanted to be doing.
What if I can't play anymore? Cole said.
Come on, Cole, cut the shit. If you'd lost that much off the end of your dick, you wouldn't even notice.
The girls might have an easier time of it, it's true.
Alex heard the strain in the humor and asked the obvious question.
What's happening with Karina?
Everything, Cole said, and then nothing. It took Alex a while to worm the story out of him. Cole answered in monosyllables, and by the end, he was in a worse funk than before. So, Alex thought, Cole is first to the pot of gold, and look at the joy it's brought him. By 9 o'clock, he was exhausted from trying to cheer Cole up. He left with the key to Cole's room at the Tyler Motor Inn, since it was already paid for. The place was a dump. Plywood walls and threadbare carpets, third-hand furniture, and no TV. Alex called home, collect, and gave his parents an update. After, he went through the closet and drawers to get an idea of how Cole had been living. The evidence was slim. Western shirts and boots, a well-thumbed copy of Playboy, the guitar sitting out ready to use, a few paperbacks, a transistor radio, the funky green tape recorder, his Chevelle's notebook, 2 warm beers in the ice chest. Alex packed the beers in fresh ice for later. No photos, no letters, no diary, nothing else to say who lived here. A few inches or a few seconds difference, and Cole could have been killed along with his friend Jerry, and this was all he would have left behind. Alex picked up the guitar and sat on the bed, plucking idly through a blues progression. This could be 5 years from now, he thought. Me and Cole on the road with whatever band we're in by then. Cole next door with some chick he'd picked up at the gig. Maybe mine's in the bathroom getting ready. Tomorrow morning, they'd be on a plane to the next stop. That was all easy enough to imagine. The hard part was going to be the next 4 weeks. For Madeline, 1966 was the summer of Maras Saad. Her father managed to put aside enough money to fly them both to New York in late June to put them up for 2 nights at the Empire Hotel on Columbus Circle, where she passed Leslie Caron in the lobby, and to get them 2 mezzanine tickets for the show on Broadway. How utterly like him. He had conceived a need to see the show and simply assumed that she would want the same thing. She did, of course. But because the idea was her father's, a price had to be paid. By means of the interlibrary loan system, he'd obtained a copy of the script in the original German and informed her that she was going to give him a 4-page typed report that detailed the most significant differences between it and the English translation. Not that it hadn't been worth it. From the minute she touched down at JFK, which she still thought of as Idlewild, she felt she was in the real world at last, to which Dallas was only the shadow on the wall of Plato's cave. They saw the Guggenheim, MoMA, and the Met while her father lectured the entire time. At the Met, they accumulated a small crowd who thought he was a professional. And when he told them at the end that tips were accepted, he took in enough to pay for that night's dinner. They ate bread and cheese lunches in Central Park the first day, and on the steps of St. Patrick's the second. Her one shopping trip was to the Drama Bookstore on 7th Avenue in Times Square, where she spent $30 of accumulated babysitting money and could easily have spent twice that. They did walk down 5th Avenue as an object lesson, her father said, like their brief glance into St. Patrick's. And then there was the play. The theater was substantially smaller than the Inwood movie theater in Dallas. The velvet of the chairs threadbare, the aisles cramped. Not that it mattered. Nothing had prepared her for the intensity of the performance, which left her febrile and physically exhausted, eyes swollen from crying, unable to keep her hands from trembling when she remembered the chorus of voices singing, "We want our revolution now." So clearly a sham within a sham, neither about the French Revolution nor de Sade's anarchic disruptions of the asylum, but about the Watts riots and the Kennedy assassination and the war in Vietnam. And because she was watching it in New York, which was so enchantingly real, the imminence of an authentic and violent revolution was that much more terrifyingly, excitingly real. They stood for a while outside the theater afterward. Her in a royal blue cotton jersey halter dress that skimmed her body, her father in his slightly shabby brown pinstripe suit. And for once, he had nothing to say. Instead, merely stood with his hands in his pockets, and a faint glow of satisfaction in his face. This, then, was the power of great art. It could even silence her father. And the one other thing. For the first time in her life, for those 2 days in New York, men turned to look at her. And for the rest of the summer in the Tom Thumb or the library or cruising Forest Lane with Hope, with increasingly friends.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.